Good morning and welcome to the 13th meeting of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee in 2021. I'd like to ask all members and witnesses to ensure their mobile phones are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. Our first item this morning is consideration of whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Item 4 will be an opportunity for members to reflect on the evidence they've heard earlier in the meeting on retrofitting housing for net zero. And item 5 will be the committee's chance to consider its approach to scrutiny of the recently laid short-term lets regulations. Do members agree to take items 4 and 5 in private? That's everyone agreed. Okay, now I've got a problem here. The second item on our agenda today is to take evidence as part of the committee's work on retrofitting housing for net zero. We will take evidence from 3 panels this morning. This will not be by any means the committee's only session on the issue, but the committee hopes today to understand more about the cost and funding of retrofitting, how retrofitting can be done in a way that considers a just transition, public engagement on retrofitting, and the skills, supply chain, and infrastructure necessary for retrofitting. On our first panel, I'd like to welcome to the committee Professor Ken Gibb, Director of the UK Collaborative Centre for Housing Evidence at the University of Glasgow, and Chris Morgan, Architect and Director at John Gilbert Architects, who was involved in the project that we're going to be discussing. Thank you for joining us today. And we will move straight to questions. Witnesses, if you wish to respond to or contribute to the discussion, please add an R in the chat box to indicate this. And we will possibly direct some of our questions to someone specifically, but because there's just 2 of you, we probably have a bit of time. We've got about 12 questions to get through. So I'm going to get started. And I think maybe I'll start with Chris. I'd like to ask you if you could give a brief overview of the purpose of the Nidhi Road project.
Okay, can everybody hear me okay?
Absolutely, yes.
Okay. The Nidhi Road project, which I believe some of you saw, and I'm sorry I wasn't there to guide you, but I know my colleague did say, it's a passive house level retrofit, so it's called Enefit. And it's an attempt to show that you can get extremely energy efficient performance from an old building, essentially. So that building will be more energy efficient than new homes, essentially. And that has an obvious benefit both to carbon emissions and to fuel poverty. We reckon that very roughly, people will be spending about £10 to £15 a month on their heating, living in those flats. So that's an enormous reduction down from, it's normally around £100. So you just can't get fuel poverty when you're paying that little for your heat. In addition to being energy efficient, we wanted it also to be healthy. So there are a number of issues we've done to address the health and well-being of tenants. And thirdly, that there are a number of things to look at, as it were, the heritage of the building. So we're looking at how the building is looked after itself, how the fabric is retained, cared for, and how we don't damage Scotland's heritage in the way that we do that.
That's great. Certainly, so myself and a few others here today did come along to the Nidhi Road project, and it was great to see the work that's being done, the care both on keeping the exterior, the front side of the building, but also I think the impression I got also was there was a good consideration on actually changing the space and making it a more pleasant interior environment, not just in terms of insulation, but also use of space. So that was really great to see that there's an opportunity to do that as well. I'd like to ask Ken Gibb, if you've got anything else you would like to add to that question around the purpose of the Nidhi Road project. You don't have to, but just in case you want to make sure something gets said.
Thank you. I think the thing I would add is that this is very much a demonstration project. It's what's possible it clearly is a radical project in the sense that it seeks to and hopefully will achieve a net zero outcome in a pre-1919 tenement. So it's a very important precedent-setting project which has lots of lessons for thinking about the retrofit of older buildings, recognising that the scale of those older tenements in Glasgow, and for those reasons, we think it's potentially a very useful lesson learning project. Two other things I'd say briefly as well is, one is, as you will have recognised when you were there last week, it's a building site and it's a project which is ongoing. So secondly, my role in this is I'm leading the evaluation that there's a research grant from the Scottish Funding Council to undertake for this work. So a lot of that evaluation really only begins when the building is handed back to the Housing Association, which will be early next year. So if I'm going to talk about some of the evaluation, it will be very preliminary, tentative, and before we have a lot of that data.
Thanks very much for pointing that out. So I'm going to move on to the next question, and this is around energy and energy efficiency. So I think, again, maybe go to Chris on this. What type of energy efficiency and low carbon heating measures does the retrofit involve, and have there been any technical challenges involved in designing and installing these measures?
Right, so the energy efficiency measures are largely largely the same as normal. So we have insulated the loft a lot. We have insulated the ground floor a lot. We have put external wall insulation on the back of the building, as you would have seen, I think, and wall insulation on the inside of the street side, the street-facing walls. So the difference between the insulation that we have done, well, there are two differences. One is that we have closed up the gaps. So in conventional work, broadly speaking, the easy bits are done, but not the difficult bits. And the difficult bits are things like where the roof meets the wall or where the wall meets the floor. And you often can't get the insulation to join. And the trouble with that is, the analogy I use, and everybody's sick of it, is holes in a bucket. You know, you used to have 10 holes in a bucket and now you've got 6. So, you know, you think you've improved things, but in reality, the heat still moves out of the building. So our job with Passive House is to close up those holes, all of them, so that there is more effort taken to messing about in the corners of things, the tricky things. A good example is at the first floor joists, for example, and this is the reason why it's difficult for this to be representative, because if you own one flat but you don't know the flat above or below, this would be very difficult. And why you need a broader and strategic approach is that we don't just stop the insulation at the floor and the ceiling. We take the insulation up through the floor, up through the ceiling and down through the floor, so that all of these gaps are joined up. Now, that's not something you can always do, but it has to happen, because the heat gets lost or the moisture can get out of the building and into the wall, and that's an issue. So we've closed up the gaps, and that's a difference. The second thing is that we're concerned about the risks of internal wall insulation. So this is a little bit technical, but essentially one difference between our project and others is that we have tested what would happen with moisture in the stone walls. And what we found is that there's a high likelihood that there would be excessive moisture, and that could lead to decay of the timber lintels over the windows and the timber floor joists. So we've gone to extra trouble and cost to design. We've used vapor permeable insulation, wood fiber, and we've designed it in such a way that shouldn't be the case. And that's not normally done. But our expectation is that means that we won't get rotten floor joists and we won't get rotten timber lintels. And that's an issue in the future for retrofit, I think. We use triple glazing, but I don't think that's particularly unusual. It's just heavier windows, which can be an issue. And we've used MVHR, which is this heat recovery ventilation, which is a bit of a faff, but fundamentally not that difficult. So I would say it's mostly the same as other renovations, with more insulation, more care taken at the corners, and an unusual solution to the internal wall insulation because of moisture and health.
Thanks for that. I'm curious about the insulation material. So we saw on the back of the building, it was completely covered in a thick insulating material, which I can't remember the name of now. But I think you said that that's maybe wood fibre, made of wood fibre.
On the back, it's mineral wool. One of the issues we've got at the moment post-Grenfell is that anything that goes on the outside of a building under our insurance terms needs to be non-combustible. So quite a lot of the plastic insulations that you might normally see aren't non-combustible. And I would prefer to use wood fibre because it's a natural material, but that is also combustible. So we've been forced really post-Grenfell to use only non-combustible materials. It's not ideal, the mineral fibre that we're using is rock wool, basically, because there are issues with moisture, but the fire risks are trumping that at the moment.
Right, okay, that's interesting, because I guess where I wanted to go with the wood fibre insulation is that something that we could start manufacturing, or is it manufactured in Scotland? Just trying to think
about... No, it's not manufactured in... It's not manufactured in Scotland, and it would be wonderful if it was.
Great. Just thinking about the kind of shortening the supply chains and, you know, being able to grow things here. I'm going to move on to another question around planning and building control. So just to hear if there were challenges that you encountered getting the project through planning or building control that you had to address.
We had almost no problems with building control. Building control took a very light touch approach to this on the basis that they said, well, when you're improving a building, where as long as you're not doing something that's obviously contradictory to the general health and safety of the building regulations, we'll support you. So, for example, the windows were, we had designed the windows in such a way as to allow to be compliant with the building regulations in terms of fire escape and child locks and so on. But the planning department insisted that we didn't do that and that we did something which to us is less safe. But the planner said it had to be done in a certain way. So we then had to contact building control and say, well, we're being asked to do something which doesn't comply with modern fire escape and safety standards. And building control said, look, you're improving the windows. We'll just let you go with whatever planning tell you to do. So building control were very good. Planning were very difficult. It took a very long time, and they were, in many cases for good reason, they were essentially against almost all of the sustainability things. So without sort of getting into too many details, I would say that the planning legislation as applied to that project was directly counter to most of the sustainability things we were trying to achieve.
Okay, so that...
I'm not saying that they were wrong to do that, because in many cases I sympathise with what they were trying to achieve, but it was counter to some of the broader sustainability issues that we were trying to address.
So in considering the speed with which we need to be rolling out retrofitting across Scotland, that sounds like maybe an area that we need to look into and address to just smooth that over somehow. Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. I just want to actually come back on the energy efficiency piece. My understanding is, so we're basing everything on EPCC rating. That's our kind of like where we're trying to get to. And what I learned shortly after election is that that rating is, I'm not sure if I've got this right, but maybe it's a benchmark to a house in Milton Keynes, something like that. But I heard that in the kind of like building industry, there is questions about whether that is the energy efficiency rating we should be working towards. I just wonder what your thoughts are on that.
I didn't know how much opportunity I'd get to speak, but I would certainly say that the SAP calculation methodology and the EPC ratings are not the way to go forward. They're not an accurate map of either buildings or where we need to go. So the very big risk to my mind is that if we stick with EPC ratings, we will go through the difficulties that we're all discussing at the moment of ramping up retrofit and the strategy and the money and the funding strategies and all of those aspects. And we will spend all this money and we won't in fact achieve either the carbon emissions or the reduction in fuel poverty, because EPCs do not in fact measure the energy efficiency of buildings particularly accurately. They obviously do a bit, That they're a system owned by a private company, which if you press them, they will admit it is not an energy efficiency calculation, it's a compliance method. So it's a way of demonstrating compliance with the building standards, but it isn't specifically an energy efficiency methodology. And there are quite a lot of problems with it, many of which could be resolved. And some of which can't. So, for example, in order to be a compliance method, you have to assume certain behaviour in the occupants. And, of course, occupants then go and do something completely different. So you don't necessarily get an accurate method, but that's not the fault of SAP. But there are a number of things which could be changed in it, which would make it far more efficient. It could also be calibrated against reality, which it isn't. So a lot of my understanding of this comes from testing buildings. So we run a project in the office called HabLab, where we go and test buildings that have been retrofitted. So we physically test them, we do air tightness tests and thermography, and we talk to the tenants and these sort of things. And we have discovered that on the whole, buildings don't operate at all as designed, because reality and what SAP and the EPC tell you are quite distinct things.
Thank you for that. I think that's an area for exploration, either for our committee or for the NZEC committee. Ken Gibb, I see that you would like to come in too.
Yeah, I just want to make two quick points. First, about planning. I think, as I said earlier, this is a demonstration project, and I think part of that is to provide guidance towards people like this Glasgow City Council to help them when they move forward with a strategy for the traditional tenement stock. And I think one of those bits of learning that we get from the project is that given that Nidvi Road is not in a conservation zone, it's an absolutely bog standard tenement of its type, that it runs up against sustainability objectives and heritage objectives, as it were, run up against the way the planning system works for normal standard tenements. So if one is considering pursuing a bigger strategy, then the planning system has to move and policies have to be set, precedents have to allow things to move forward in different ways. The other thing I'd say very briefly about EPC is that our colleague on the project, Professor Tim Sharp, who's an architecture professor at Strathclyde University, is particularly good on discussing the problems with SAP and EPC. And he would point to literature as well, academic literature, which raises some of the problems with EPC and SAP that, that Chris has already raised.
Thank you for that. That's great. So I'm going to move to Eleanor Whitten with another question.
Thank you very much, Convener. And before I start my questions, I would just refer everyone to my register of interest. I'm still a serving councillor in East Ayrshire Council. So I'd like to direct my first question, please, to Professor Gibb. And you've already alluded to the fact that this is a demonstrator project and obviously in its very early stages. So far, are there any cost-benefit analysis of the demonstrator project available? We've already heard from Craig a question in terms of the fuel cost reductions for tenants, but I'm wondering in terms of the project itself, how would it compare to demolishing and refreshing the stock totally? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Well, that's a really good question. We're actually doing this right now. We're trying to make sense. Cost-benefit analysis is quite a big part of the overall evaluation, but it's more work in principle at this stage than in practice, because we're still waiting for some of the costs to be actually available. So, but let me explain what we're trying to do. You need to have counterfactuals against the work of the retrofit project. So we're comparing it with if there'd only been a basic refurbishment of the properties, and we're comparing it with a demolition and new build. So we can see quite clearly in terms of embodied carbon and such like that there's clearly an extensive cost to new build. We can also see that the refurbishment on its own, almost by definition, would be cheaper than doing the refurbishment plus the retrofit. That's just by definition true. But on the other hand, the refurbishment will have further costs attached to trying to seek improvements. So, for instance, if it fell under the EASH rules, which it would do, if it was social housing, as it will be, they would need to achieve those standards. So there would be further costs that would have to be met to do that. We also recognise that with Enerfit type retrofit, we expect the energy performance of new build and the energy performance of the refurbishment to have gaps in performance. They won't do as well as we think the Enerfit would do. So there are further energy costs or carbon costs attached to that. We also think that because we would have social tenants or mid-market rent tenants in the properties, that there would be a distributional profile, so there would be a positive distributional effect, a redistribution of resource in favour of lower income groups than would be the case if it was just the population as a whole. So there are a number of points of principle, but unfortunately at this stage we don't have all of the costs to basically pin things down. But I want to make the point that we're trying to do this on as close to a conventional Green Book approach as we can, but one which includes fully the monetized value of carbon savings and the monetized value of embodied carbon. That's our aspiration, and we hope that that will be available in the new year.
Thank you very much for that really brilliant explanation of that. I'm going to hand it back over to the convener because I think one of my colleagues has a supplementary question on to that question.
Yes, I'd like to bring in Mark Griffin, who's joining us online.
Thanks, convener. Good morning. I just wanted to ask further to the question around costs. And obviously, if this rolled out nationally, you would expect costs to come down because of scaling up the project, you expect unit costs to come down. But I just wanted to ask about whether the panel felt it was reasonable that as we move out to mixed tenure models where there are potentially owner occupiers, or even in the example that we have just now, whether you would expect the burden of the cost of the initial project either to fall on tenants and increase rents, or to fall on an owner occupier, whether you think it's reasonable to expect the social landlord or the owner occupier to pick up all the costs, and whether that is feasible or not, whether there has to be a greater incentive through government grants to cover this, whether or not that would hold back any potential national rollout.
I'll go first. Thanks for the question. We recognise, of course, that this is a very, very unusual demonstration project in the sense that it's an empty block and there are no tenants living in it. It will be run by, owned by a social landlord. We should bear in mind the fact, though, that the Housing Association, through private finance, is making a very major contribution to the cost of the project. So their tenants will be, you know, repaying rents as part of the cost of the thing. It's undoubtedly the case that Enerfit standards, by definition, is higher cost than some of the other kinds of retrofit around EPCC and such like that we hear so much about. And clearly there are a whole set of issues as soon as you have multiple ownership in a tenement. And we absolutely recognise that. So it's been interesting looking, for instance, at the Glasgow City Region scoping research for their plans for a retrofit economic strategy, that there's a very strong recognition of how do you manage the different interests of owner-occupiers, private landlords, as well as social landlords. And I think personally that we need to have a well-communicated route to owners, be they landlords or owner-occupiers, which give them a menu of choices. They are asset owners, so I think there's a sense where they can certainly contribute and share in the cost. But yes, absolutely, depending on people's resources, depending on their income, depending on their wealth, actually, as well, the actual value of the property, we need to think about grants, we need to think about loans and low-cost loans. We need to also think about payment deferral mechanisms where costs might be transferred forward in time until a property is sold. But we need to have institutions to be able to organise all of that. I think all of those things are important, and we do need, and it needs to be just. So we obviously have a lot of people who are owner-occupiers who are not wealthy, who don't have high incomes, who may be older in life and have less resource. So there's a whole set of tactics and strategies around that, and we haven't really begun that yet. I think what reflecting on this single project tells us about is also about the variety of housing in Glasgow and the variety of situations that individual tenants in tenements have and owners in tenements have. There's 70-odd thousand of these tenement flats in Glasgow. And so all of those things have to be considered. And underlying all of that, underlying all of that, I think, is the fundamental maintenance of tenements themselves. You know, there's little point in thinking about retrofit if the property fundamentally isn't maintained in a sustainable way in the first place. And we know that many tenements need considerable repair, that there are real problems with that, and I think it's well reflected in the previous Parliament's tenement maintenance working group, who did such excellent work. And all of that pointed towards the need for fundamental tenement law reform. So there are several layers here of things that have to be done. We're exposing one particular issue within a broader kind of ecosystem, how to make tenements work and be sustainable. So I absolutely accept the complexities and the high costs that are involved when you look at the city as a whole or Scotland as a whole, but it's actually part of a broader set of housing questions which are themselves challenging but have to be exposed and embraced.
Thank you for that. And we're going to go back to Elena for a follow-up question.
Thanks very much, Convener. So following on from that issue, Professor Gibb, do you think that the heat and building strategy provides sufficient clarity about the Scottish Government's approach to multi-tenure buildings? Thank you.
I think it's a beginning, but I don't think it's an end. I think, again, referring back to the Glasgow City Region Grant Thornton report, it's clear that you can kind of scope out the level of resources that are required to achieve even a fairly, in their case, I think a modest improvement relative to what we're talking about in the Nidbury Road. But they're identifying a significant gap of funding, which they look to come from the UK government as well as the Scottish government. And so there are assumptions about what resource will be available and critically when it will be available, because this will take a decade or two, and there are those other things going on. So the critical area for multiple tenure ownership is the tenement. An awful lot of people in Glasgow and Edinburgh live in tenements, but we also need real progress with the kind of tenement law reform, I think, to make all that happen. So it's not just about the building and heating strategies. These complementary but really fundamental things alongside it that we also have to make progress with as well.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And we're going to go to Miles Briggs with a question.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I wanted to ask a few questions with regards to engagement with tenants and specifically around decision making on these projects going forward. And I just wondered, in terms of Southside Housing Association, how that was taken forward and sort of best practice around that as well. Maybe Chris, I think you've got your hand up.
Yes, but I knew I was mute. There are quite a number of ways that we can engage with tenants. So just to say, when we study buildings and we discover that things don't work the way we predicted, one of the biggest variables that we discover is that people use buildings in a way that we didn't anticipate. And particularly often don't understand the controls in their buildings. So there are lots of reasons for that. So in this project, Ken has alluded to Professor Tim Sharp, who will be running the engagement with the tenants. I think in collaboration with Southside Housing Association, there will be meetings with the tenants before they go into the building. There will be meetings with tenants, at least one or two anyway, once they've entered the building. We have provided something called Quick Start Guides, which are a very basic introduction to both the building and the control systems, the services within that building, because we find that information on services can often be, you know, it's a sort of 50 pages of German text about your boiler wiring system, which, you know, nobody needs to know. But understanding how you keep warm in the sun, keep warm in winter and cool in summer, those sort of basic things, that's useful to give people. We've also taken some control to make sure that the controls themselves are clear and obvious and well explained when people move in. And there's a little bit of work about explaining to people why it's worth taking trouble with their, you know, it's not just a question of sticking the thermostat up, it's about understanding the interrelationships. And it's not particularly complicated, but many people don't understand how their building works. So just taking the time to engage is a really important part of getting the energy efficiency that you're hoping for.
Thank you for that. I don't know if Professor Gibb wanted to come in.
Yeah, just to amplify that really, we think this is an important part of the evaluation, as well as being a tremendously useful part of the demonstration project itself. So we are using tried and tested techniques to do these pre and post occupancy surveys. We will have to do the post occupancy surveys twice because the tenants are likely to move into the properties in around March time. So we're going to miss the first winter. We'll be monitoring them while they're in the summer, as it were. So we want to try to make sure we come back and do another survey with the residents the following March or so. We're also, with the permission of the tenants, and that's still to be obviously decided, we don't know who the tenants are yet, but with their permission, we want to monitor the building and actually have sensors in the building to see how temperature and moisture vary and such like. So the idea is to compare their lived experience of being in the property, their ability to use the documentation and the training that Chris has just talked about, but also to have a kind of objective measure against that of how the building's actually performing at the same time. That we are, again, in a really privileged position to be able to do this because we will have an empty property with new tenants coming in. And we may well not have all of the tenants wanting to participate in this, but we just need a small number of them to stick with it, and we'll have a tremendously valuable set of data that comes out of that. And we think that there's lots of really interesting questions about how people actually use buildings, particularly when they're being able to live in a property which is quite different to anything they will have lived in before. So that's quite exciting.
Thanks for that. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to go to questions from Paul McClellan.
Thanks, convener, and thank you, panel. And before I ask the first question, I'll just refer everyone to my register of interest. I'm a serving councillor on East Lothian Council at the moment. Ken, this is probably for yourself, Professor Gibbs, for yourself, and it's really around about, you've touched on this already, around about the role of the City Council, but broader, what role that councils would need to play in facilitating similar work across wider areas. And just in addition to that as well, it's really just your comments on looking at probably a wider local heat and energy strategies, you know, whether that's a way ahead, because I think each local authority is obviously different in how it would scale this up. So just your views on that, and I think you touched also on the evaluation of the project, and just to say a little bit more, if you've anything to add on, about how you would share the findings of that as well.
Right, certainly. I sit on the housing portfolio of the Glasgow City Region, so I've been involved in watching how the strategy has evolved over time, and that seemed to me to be a sensible level of examination of the issue, because it's effectively a local labour market area. You know, it's a functional economic region, which makes sense to think about construction and skills and supply chains, as well as it does to think about the housing market as a system. You know, so that as a strategy seems to me to make sense, but clearly local government per se will be in different geographical places and in different combinations of those functional economies. But it seems to me that partnership across local authority boundaries, where there's a kind of economic rationale for it, must make some sense at some level. So that's the starting point for me, I guess. Could you remind me what your first point was?
I think in about the City Council facilitating the project, but you know, what role do councils need to play in facilitating, I suppose, similar work across wider areas? I think you've almost kind of touched on that as well, just with the point you mentioned about that. And
yes, I think the other thing I was going to say with regard to that was, I think the City Council has been an excellent partner of ours. They've not only put a lot of capital funding into the project, but they've been a partner in the sense that we've talked through various stages of the work with them, and I think they've wanted to have, you know, the nature of a kind of pilot like this or demonstration is to surface problems, and I think we have surfaced some issues and challenges And we've done some public meetings of late, and the head of housing in the council was able to say, even at this stage, there are elements or components of this work which will be replicable or usable in the strategy. We of course recognise that there are very idiosyncratic and specific features of the NIDRIVO development, but I think that's a really interesting partnership which relates to their housing strategy, specific tenant strategy, and the retrofit strategy. So that's a very important part of it. On the evaluation, the evaluation is really four or five separate but linked evaluations which we'll try to synthesise. So we're trying to understand in real time, as it were, the decision making that's been made. When we start off with a retrofit on paper and then try to make it real, what sort of decisions do you have to go through? What can we learn from that? And what can other projects learn from that? We're doing the cost benefit analysis that we talked about before. We're doing a kind of building performance evaluation, which Tim Sharp is leading on with working with Chris. And we're going to try and synthesise these elements. And we're also going to have this pre and post occupancy qualitative research linked to the building performance measurement. So we've, as you probably know, we've made a film already about the project, which is available on YouTube, and it's been well watched, widely watched. We're going to make a second film once the residents are in and once we've done some of the post-occupancy survey work. We will certainly be disseminating it in the normal way, hopefully through face-to-face events, but almost certainly on a webinar basis at the minimum. And there will be a series of publications. There will be a main report, there will also be policy and practice briefs. There will be some summary documents as well. And we will, you know, we are very aware of the really high level of interest and engagement in this project. So we, Scottish Funding Council, are really keen that we promote what we find as widely as we can, and that's certainly what we intend to do. So we'll probably start publishing working papers and things of that kind in the February, March time, I would think.
Yeah, thank you. And just one other question that's probably this time to Chris, and it's just, Chris, briefly if you can, it's really talking in about the issues of if you've had any supply chain issues or availability of skilled labour. And I think that's obviously then how we then to look to scale this up. If that's a problem, you know, is there going to be issues with supply and with skilled labour? I know it's hard to say and looking at scaling up, but in your view at the moment, do you think that would be an issue?
There have been delays. The contractor asked for an extension of time on the contract because of delays, largely due to materials rather than labour, I believe. It, funnily enough, because some of the materials we had specified were unusual or European, that there wasn't such a backlog on requiring those. So that was the biggest problems they've had are with things like mineral wool and plasterboard, I think, because everybody wants them at the moment and there are backlogs. Skill shortage, not really, although they did have problems initially sourcing somebody to do the lime plastering, because lime is a relatively traditional skill set. It's not just cement, and we needed it to be lime so that it didn't crack and move. But on the whole, no. I think the difficulties that have happened to the project in terms of supply chain have been more to do with, you know, the current issues around Brexit or COVID, rather than any sort of major structural problems that we've got. Yes, I think that's a fair comment.
Okay, thanks, Seth. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. We're just going to go briefly to Miles Briggs with another question, and then Eleanor Whittam. And I would just invite you to keep your answers tight.
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to ask a quick question with regards to what evaluations likely to take place to look at how this work can benefit the health of residents specifically. You've already touched upon the evaluation period, Professor Gibb, not taking in winter, but I just wondered how that would be maybe also measured.
Well, thank you for that. I think a significant part of the building performance analysis is exactly about that. We're very interested in the internal circulation of air, of moisture. You know, there's obviously an extensive literature which says these things are associated, damp and condensation, etc., are associated with health problems. And I know Chris is of the view that the kind of natural materials that we've used, and the decisions not to do certain things like chemically treat things are important parts of trying to improve the health of the building and hence the people inside the building. Chris might have some more to say about that than I have.
I think it's key that passive house is generally considered a comfort strategy. So it's about keeping people warm. That's the number one issue, is keeping people warm when it's cold. Maintaining the air quality. There will be subjective discussions with people, but there will also be objective measurement, as Ken has said, to do with air quality, moisture, temperature. Those are the main things. But then there are also things like the chemicals, the VOCs, which we will be looking at as well.
Thanks.
Thank you. And Eleanor.
Thank you very much, Convener. It's already been alluded to during the evidence session this morning that there's going to be tensions between balancing up the needs for climate change being addressed and also Scotland's built heritage. So if we think about that in terms of the planning system, how do you think that that's going to affect our ambitions going forward, and how do we square those two together? I know that's a big question, but I'm going to put it out there because I think it's going to be one of the major issues that we have when it comes to retrofitting our built heritage. Thank you. I'll go to both of you, but we'll start with Professor Gibb. Thanks.
Well, I agree. It's one of those classic points where there needs to be movement, it seems to me. I think, in a sense, that's stating the obvious. I go back to the earlier point about if we're serious about protecting the tenement way of life and its neighbourhood and its well-being factors and the things that it does so well, as well as the actual building heritage, then we have to recognise that there's significant climate change, net zero related work that has to be done, and there's clearly a significant cost to that. But it's a political choice at some level that has to be made, which requires a shift in some of the nostrums that exist at the moment. Again, I think Chris is probably better placed to discuss this than I am, but that's what I would say.
Yep, Chris, if you want to come in. Yep.
The easiest way to answer it, I think, is what we've done at Nidri Road, which is to say that we recognise that the public space, the street, the public facing, we want to try and retain that as much as we possibly can. That limits our ability to reduce the energy consumption. So what we've done is we've compensated at that by insulating at the back. So I think the way we've approached it at Nidri Road is the way that strategically makes sense, which is to protect the public space visually, but to work hard on all those unseen aspects in terms of insulation and covering up. And then there are issues with renewables and where you can put them and so on and so forth, how you deal with windows. But yes, I think the way we did it at Nidri Road is the way forward. You keep the front relatively similar, but you work on the back, and you accept defeat from a heritage point of view at the back of buildings in the courts. In the rear courts, I think that's a reasonable compromise, and I think that generally could apply more widely.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for that. And I'd like to just actually come on the back of that to ask if there are any other Enerfit projects tackling other types of housing stock in Scotland that you're aware of, because clearly it's not just going to be tenements. There's other housing stock, and maybe go to Professor Gibb on that.
Yeah, well, again, we kind of showcase it in our film that we made. There's a Queen's Cross Housing Association development of multi-stories, which is Enerfit improved by Collective Architects. And they're mentioned in our film, and that seems to have been highly successful as well. So, and it's as radically different to what we're doing as what they did, but it's exactly the same principles.
And being an MSP who represents the Highlands and Islands, so more rural areas, are you aware of anything happening rurally, or have we not gone there yet?
Again, I would defer to Chris, I think.
Okay. Chris?
Yeah. Yes, we're working on a number of Enerfit projects, including, you'll be pleased to know, a domestic retrofit in Fort William. So yes, it works at any scale. It's worth mentioning that we are also working on retrofit two other standards, some of which are less onerous than ENEFIT. And the one that's probably worth drawing your attention to is one called the AECB retrofit standard. AECB is Association of Environment Conscious Building, but they have developed a standard which is less onerous than ENEFIT in terms of energy efficiency, but broader in terms of its remit towards maintenance, heritage and health and moisture and that sort of thing. And we will be hopefully undertaking a similar retrofit project in Govan Hill, just, 200 yards away, to that standard with Govan Hill Housing Association. That's what I'm hoping will take place. And I think that that standard may have broader applicability because it will be slightly easier, but with a broader remit. And that is worth you knowing about.
Thank you for that. It's good to know that there are other things. It feels like we've got so much work to do here that it's good to hear that there are examples and also of this other standard. Thank you for drawing our attention to that as well. So that's all we've had time for this morning. Clearly, we could talk more. It was very, very good to come along and see the building and the work being done. And I think, I'm hoping that people will have a great home when the project's done. So thanks. It was good to meet you both. Thank you. Going to suspend to allow changeover of witnesses. Welcome back, and we're going to continue taking evidence on retrofitting housing for net zero, and we welcome our second panel this morning. We have Bruce Cuthbertson, he's the chairperson of East Ayrshire Federation, of tenants and residents. Aaron Hill, who's the director of policy and membership from the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations. Brian Leask, chief executive Yelpland Housing Association Limited. And Derek Logie, who's the Chief Executive of Rural Housing Scotland. Thank you for joining us today, and we're going to move straight to questions. And if witnesses, if you wish to respond or contribute to the discussion, please put an R in the chat box to indicate this. We only have 45 minutes together, unfortunately, so we'll probably direct our questions to somebody specific. And if you feel like there's something that's not being raised in response to the question, please come in. But don't feel that you all have to come in because two people have come in. It's just because of time. Clearly, we could speak to you all day on these issues. So I'd like to start around the theme of cost and financing. And would like to ask, who would I like to ask, actually, having said that specificness, So I'm going to direct my question initially to Aaron Hill around the do you believe that the Scottish Government are sufficiently aware of the costs involved with retrofitting homes at a national level?
Thanks, Convener. So I think my starting point for that would be that housing associations are still themselves working to understand the cost of retrofitting and reaching new energy standards. We currently have the Energy Efficiency Standard for Social Housing version 2 on the table. And some work that we've done at SFHA with ChangeWorks estimates that the cost of that would be about £2 billion. Now, if you compare that to Scottish Government's own figures, they say about £6 billion for the whole sector, including local authorities. So they're fairly similar estimates. What I would say is that when we did that work with ChangeWorks, that £2 billion investment was estimated to only reduce fuel poverty by about 25%. And I think when we look at funding and when we look at the standards that are driving that funding, it's really important that we align those two things a bit better. We know that in the same way in which we build homes, funding for energy efficiency measures will be a partnership effort between government, between housing associations, and between private lenders. I think the question that we probably haven't fully grasped collectively yet is what that balance is between those three partners. Fairly well established principle when it comes to new development, but lending for new development is incumbent on the additional rent that you will make as a result of those new homes being built. It's not obvious at this point where further revenue will be made from energy efficiency to service the additional lending that will be needed. So I think I would point to the work that was done by the Zero Emissions Task Force earlier this year, which the SFHA co-chaired, which talked about the need for a sector capacity assessment to look at some of these issues, to understand what the balance of funding is, to understand how much we can bring in from private lenders, how much government can afford. And what we need to see is really to match that ambition that government has with the appropriate level of funding. I think the short answer is probably at the moment, we haven't quite seen the level of funding we need for the ambition that is there, but there's still work to do to better understand where that's coming from, the exact bill. And I think to inform that, a review of those standards, aligning the standards better with fuel poverty targets, and as well as energy efficiency, will be really important.
Thank you for that. And I'd like to add on to that, just kind of adding to that question, how can local authorities and housing associations prepare for the scale of the work and the investment ahead? And I think I'd like to bring someone else in, so maybe bring in Bruce Cuthbertson on that, and you can pick up any response to the previous question too.
Yes, I think this is something that's got to happen for us to reach zero emissions in social housing. But there is examples of local councils and local housing associations and people in the private sector working together during types of retrofit, getting the houses enveloped, like what we were doing in East Ayrshire for quite a wee while. And there is examples throughout Scotland that this system works in areas, but I think it will need to be a wee bit more robust and maybe better defined.
Thank you for that. And I'm going to go on to a question for Derek Logie. And please do put an R in the chat box if I'm skipping over and you really do want to comment on anything. But yeah, for Derek, are there any specific cost implications for retrofit projects in rural and island areas? I'm sure there are. I'd love to hear more about that. How do these costs compare to each other? And is this recognised sufficiently in existing funding?
Well, by and large, property in rural Scotland, well, there's two main differences. One, it's older, and two, it's often in the private sector. And it's something like 85% of buildings are either owner-occupied or in the private rented sector. So social housing is really just 15% of people who live in rural Scotland live in social housing. So the measures, and the very welcome measures such as EASH and all these things, are not measures that are reaching rural Scotland, or reaching 15% of the population there. And the issues that come with older buildings, which are stone built, which are perhaps more exposed, which are perhaps have more challenging weather conditions, mean that the issues to tackle those are required more extensive. Because it's interesting to see that if you look at the level of loft insulation in homes in rural Scotland, it's actually quite high. Yet the level of extreme fuel poverty in rural Scotland is still also extraordinarily high. Something like a third of households in remote rural areas are in extreme fuel poverty. And that points to the fact that there's measures beyond increasing loft insulation that require. There's measures which are more expensive, which are required, such as external wall insulation, which has its own problems regarding planning, etc. Internal wall insulation, which also has its own problems regarding room sizes and restrictions on those, because a lot of older properties aren't necessarily the biggest properties going. So these are all like very expensive measures. I was speaking to the development manager of the Isle of Alva yesterday, who are renovating 6 homes there, and they're aiming to try and get to D, but their ability to do that is limited by the physical constraints of the building, but also by costs associated with trying to overcome those. For example, you know, a lot of those older properties have no space beneath the floors in which to put underfloor insulation. The joists in the ceilings and in the walls are narrow, so they can't really put an awful lot of insulation in those. And others have an existing concrete floor, and they're not going to go to the expense of breaking that out and putting a new one in. And they can't put insulation on top of the floor, otherwise you wouldn't be able to get into the homes through the door. So there's a number of more extensive measures that are required, and they require a lot more funding, and they also require that funding to be. They need a lot of navigation around that funding, because at the moment it's a bit of an alphabet soup in terms of how you get a hold of funding and who you get it from. And so agencies like Tánaiste Gael or Alley Energy or the Scannalcash Energy Advice Service are really important in terms of helping people and pointing people towards getting a hold of the right funding that they require. And I think those are essential, because I think up to now, you know, I think my impression is that we have been able to spend a lot of money dealing with the low-hanging fruit, to the stuff that's easier to do, and by and large, that stuff is those homes have been in towns and cities.
Thank you for that. Yes, I think that is possibly the case. Brian, I think you would like to come in on this as well.
Yeah, I think it was the kind of previous question as well, Convener, on the funding element, but the two I think are linked together. I think it is more expensive to build in rural areas, there's no question on that. It's recognised through the new build standard. So when we do a new build scheme, the Scottish Government sets a target within that, but also it indicates within a kind of locational basis what the increase will be based on tenders from the past. From a Shetland perspective, our cost is recognised as being 34%. Higher than it is on a national basis. We think in realistic terms, it's actually probably closer to 40 to 45%, but that's the figure that's being recognised by Scottish Government already. The question then comes back down to funding. Your first question was in relation to that. I think the underlying issue I've got with the funding availability is zero energy and zero carbon is now clearly seen as a strategic priority by government. But the problem then links back down to that the funding has not been allocated on a strategic basis. Funding has still been allocated on a bid process, and we are then competing against other organisations. And the point that Derek made about that low-hanging fruit is absolutely right. so the Scottish Government, for its public money, can get more bang for its buck by going into the urban areas, where it is, if you use Scottish Government figures, 34% cheaper to do than it is to do in Shetland. But we are in Shetland with the highest wind speed in the country, the highest level of fuel poverty in the country, but the cost of element in doing that work is more expensive. And if we are competing against other organisations for that funding, whether it's through eco-funding, whether it's through area-based schemes or warmer home schemes, we are in a competitive stream. Scottish Government needs to take a strategic priority on the funding element as well as a strategic priority on the targets that are set.
Thank you very much for that. It's good to get the Shetland high wind speed perspective and the higher percentage in terms of cost. I'd like to move over to a new theme on just transition, and Eleanor Whittam is going to pick up there.
Thanks very much for that, convener. And I'm going to start with Bruce Cuthbertson from the East Ayrshire Federation. Now, Bruce, I know that you love to scrutinise the housing revenue account and how the housing improvement plan fits into that locally and then nationally in terms of the role that you have with the Tenant Improvement Service as well. Do you have a fear that tenants are bearing an undue cost of retrofitting socially rented homes locally and nationally? Thanks.
Yes, I think I should say at this stage I'm part of a national HRA group and a rent affordability group with the Scottish Government, and it differs from place to place, but the system itself for the individual is slightly flawed. If we look at rent setting at the moment, it differs slightly from area to area, but basically there's a proposal put out to the tenants and it will say we will do so much capital programme work, so many kitchens and bathrooms, so many central heating systems, so many roofs, and so many envelopes on the building, and then you pay a choice. I think this year is 1.5–2.5% above last year's rent. And that, for the individual, you're actually paying for the upgrades to somebody else's house. And it could be 10, 15 years before you actually see a saving in your house. So individually, and EPCs comes into this as well. I don't want to jump the gun a wee bit, but whatever way we decide to look at this, there's got to be some sort of saving. If we do a certain amount of work, we put insulation outside it, make sure the rest of the house is insulated, etc., etc., we have got to say, if we spend this amount, increase your rent by, say, £2 a week, we will save you £3 a week on your power bills, and it's got to go. But that can't happen in the present system. So I see poverty getting worse before it maybe starts to get better. And I don't really like the view at the moment, but I may be wrong.
Thanks very much for that, Bruce. And I'm going to ask to Aaron, from an SFHA perspective on it. We've already heard from Bruce there and also from Derek with regards to fuel poverty. And I'm just wondering how retrofitting and housing for net zero can be delivered in a way that's consistent with a just transition. So perhaps to widen it out a little bit. And Aaron, I would like to hear your perspective. Thank you.
Thanks. I don't want to talk exclusively about funding today, but I think that some of this does come back to the funding question. Ultimately, as a housing association, when you're making the level of investment that is required to deliver the energy efficiency measures that we're looking at, there's absolutely no question from any housing association I speak to about the commitment to do that, and that is the right thing for the environment, for communities and for tenants. But we have to find a way to fund it, and that either comes through increases in rent or through increases in grant funding. And we need to make sure that balance is right, because as Bruce has just said, we can't end in a situation where energy bills come down slightly as a result of energy efficiency measures, but rents increase astronomically. That is not a position that any housing association wants to be in. So we need to get that balance of funding right from government. We need to make sure that there is enough grant funding to to allow housing associations to make those decisions and to keep rents as low as possible. I think the other thing that's important here is about the impact on energy bills. I think we can often assume that investment in energy efficiency will result in lower energy bills when we know that it doesn't always. A lot of the assumptions around retrofitting move tenants from gas boilers to electric heating system. And we know that electric costs more. So we think that one of the ways you can get around that is the fabric first approach. You absolutely have to invest in the fabric of the home first. You have to ensure that those properties are as airtight and as energy efficient as possible before addressing the heating systems. And what we've seen in previous iterations of funding from Scottish Government, and this is true across the UK and other parts of Europe as well, I don't think it's something that's exclusively happening in Scotland, that investment has gone into heating systems. So we've seen incentives to fit heating systems, which might not then work with the footprint of that property or with the energy efficiency of that property as it stands. We need to be looking at the whole system to be able to deliver that just transition. We need to get the funding right. We need to get the standards right. We need to get the incentives right, keep rents low, and to actually genuinely reduce energy bills as a result.
Thank you very much, Aaron.
Thank you. And we're going to go to my colleague, Willie Coffey, who is joining us online for the next theme, which is public engagement and local communities.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to everybody in the panel. I just wanted to try and broaden the question to the wider issue of public awareness, public engagement. Where do you think we are with this? Now, the target for us is to try and get 1 million houses with zero emissions over the next 10 years. That's over 100,000 houses per year between now and then. Broadly speaking, maybe come to Bruce first. Bruce, what's your perspective on the awareness of the public about this whole agenda that we're embarking on here? Are they signed up to it? Are they aware of it? Are they expecting it to be done? Do they anticipate help and assistance to get there? Just a flavour of what you think we need to do to raise public awareness of the whole agenda. Thank you.
I think with recent events in Glasgow, COP26, I think it is in the forefront. But I was actually talking to somebody yesterday about this, and there is similarities between achieving what we're trying to achieve in COVID and the vaccines. You have people that say it doesn't affect them. You have people that will, if you had to say, I'll sign up for the vaccine and see it, and the other says various other options. So there's a definitely a parallel thing. Public engagement. Yeah, there's plenty of talks in this, especially on the television at COP26. Actually, I think area for area, there's got to be conversations. And organisations like myself and nationally, we've been talking about this for quite a wee while. So the word is getting out there. But I think it's time that we actually got a lead on what's actually going to happen. I think we've got to lay out the journey, where the stops, and I'm aware of the figures of 1 million, and it's, to some people it's not achievable. I was part of the ZEST working group during the summer, and I think it is achievable, but it's got to be government-led. And I'll include the Westminster government in this, when it comes to the affordability thing, because a lot of the discussion is around affordability. The tax system between gas and electricity has to be looked at. If we're trying to get away from gas, something is going to be made to make electricity cheaper. And the word, something else that was come up in the ZEST, was the fact that all this retrofit work, there's VAT on top of it. So on one hand, we're looking for grant funding, and then we're paying a lot. The various organisations are paying a lot of that back in VAT. So I think the tax system, something has got to be done to make it more affordable. And I think it's not so much that we have to achieve it. I think we've got to, the phrase just transition has got to take place, and it's round about affordability.
Thanks for that, Bruce. Just maybe to the other members of the panel, how do we take the public along with us on this journey? The government's intending to set up the National Public Energy Agency, hopefully to coordinate a lot of this. What kind of work do you think we need to do to engage much more directly with many more of the public to make sure that they participate in this whole agenda?
If I could just come in on that, I think that I think Bruce is spot on. I think in what he said, we have seen, I guess, this kind of peak of public awareness now around climate change and around the need for action. I'm still not convinced that at large people have fully understood what that means in terms of individual consequences and the consequences to homes, for example. So I think that there's still a journey to go on there. There's a really interesting piece of work carried out in the north of England earlier this year by the Northern Housing Consortium. They ran a social housing tenants climate jury. And the recommendations from that climate jury are really, really interesting. The number one recommendation is the work on energy efficiency needs to be done more quickly. People's homes, people are anticipating that work. They want it to be done and they want to see it done really well. The majority of the other recommendations are around communication. So, I think there is a unique role that housing associations can play in that communication with their tenants. I think we're probably going to have to see slightly different models of tenant engagement, if I'm honest, on this stuff. You know, I think when we think about what the model of tenant engagement has been in the past, we have often seen some of the same people, some of the same faces engaging in that. And this is going to have an impact on everybody's home. The housing association is going to have to think about how they can deliver slightly different models of engagement, how they can have those conversations about what it means. There's going to be a degree of education to that. So how does this new heating system work in my home? What does it mean in terms of, one of your previous witnesses was talking about tenant behaviours in passive house. For example, in homes that are particularly tight, opening the windows is bad in a heating home. I also then think the role of local authorities will be really important. We've heard a couple of mentions already about local heat and energy strategies. And there is a duty within that for local authorities to consult locally and widely with communities. And when we think about some of the other types of energy system, local heat networks, those sorts of things, that journey is going to be really, really important. So there's a long way to go, I think, but it's something that is at the forefront of all of our minds at the moment.
Thank you, Aaron. Brian and Derek, any further comment you could add to this about the wider public engagement agenda and how we improve it?
Yeah, I mean, I think generally, well, yeah, I think we just need to be honest with the public. We need to have that honest conversation because move, as you said, a million homes off of gas onto zero carbon heat post at the moment is effectively moving that either onto an electric heating system or a district heating system. Now, if we move that to an electric heating system, you've all read about the increase in cost of electric heating at the moment. But you're looking at 25 to 28 pence per kilowatt hour for electric as opposed to 4 pence a kilowatt hour for gas. So even if we get a coefficient element along with the heat pump, we're not bridging that gap between the two. As it stands at the moment, the average cost difference between running a house on gas and running it purely on electric is about £1,600 per year. We need to be honest about it. I think the other question we need to kind of raise at that point, and again it's a question back to government, is what it is we're actually trying to achieve? Is it the zero carbon element? Because if we move a million homes off of gas and move it on to district heating or move it on to the electric heating, that each target that we as social landlords have got to try and meet by 2032, as it stands at the moment, will get worse in those million homes because it's based on an EPC rating, and an EPC rating is based on the cost of heating. So if we move away from a very cheap cost of heating to an expensive cost of heating, EPC rating will get worse. So the level of funding required to bring us up to that level again, once we move off of that cheap, carbon expensive fuel, then becomes more and more expensive for either the landlord or for government or however that funding matrix then comes back into it.
Thank you, Brian. Derek, a final comment on this point?
Yeah, I would just add, I think I think it's really important that we invest in local information provision. I think some of the most successful areas which have engaged with the public on energy efficiency and fuel poverty have been those areas where there is a local provision, such as in Sky and Lough Allach with the Energy Advice Service that the Lough Allach Sky Housing Association run. And they do things like even just persuading people to change suppliers, you know, and helping them work that through, and doing things like just paying for electricity usage on a new supplier, for example, for a month, just to prove that it's more viable. But they also help you navigate I've talked about the alphabet soup of energy measures and the numerous different schemes that you can get involved in. I mean, I stay in an old house in a rural area, and I've been quite, we've got money to help us put in a biomass and various things and move away from oil. But it takes a lot of effort and a lot of time and a lot of energy to actually do that, and you really need somebody holding your hand. And I think those local agencies like Tan Shikal and the Lakash have been really important in doing that.
Thanks very much to all of you for your answers to on that issue. Back to you, convener. Thank you.
Thank you, Willie. And yeah, it was very good to hear those responses. I'm going to move on to a question from Megan Gallagher, but I'm just going to do a little adjustment because we've got about 14 minutes left for this session. So if we can keep our answers to the point and succinct, and come in if you really feel like something has not been raised. So, Megan.
Thank you very much, convener. And before I ask my question this morning, I would like to refer everyone to my register of interest, as I am a serving councillor at North Lanarkshire Council. And my question relates around retrofitting and protecting communities, because I'm quite interested in the relationship between retrofitting and protecting the distinctive characteristics of individual places. So I would like to ask the panel, how do we protect the character of a community? And similar to Willie Coffey's question, how do we involve communities to make sure that their views are represented? And again, that element of protection in terms of their community is in place. And if I could start with Aaron, please.
Aaron, coming. I think you're on, Aaron. Oh, gone again.
Oh, yeah. So sorry, I lost my connection briefly there. So I might have missed the question.
Okay. So, Megan, could you ask the question again?
Of course, I can. Aaron, it relates to the relationship between retrofitting and protecting the distinctive characters of individual places. So I'm wondering, how do we protect the character of our current communities? And similar to Willie Coffey's question, how do we get members of the public and our communities involved in that process so their views are being heard and their love of their community is protected?
So, and apologies for the connection issues. I think that there was a response to this earlier from one of the witnesses about kind of how they'd achieved that on the tenement building. I think that's a fantastic example of kind of protect the public realm and look for innovative solutions, the tricky bits that often people can't get into in retrofit, really getting into the insulation and kind of thinking about that. I also think there's something cultural here about the approach of planners and the approach of local authorities. These are
Megan, maybe you want to pick up with somebody else, and then maybe we'll get Aaron back. But is there someone else you'd like to ask the question to?
Of course. If I could go to Derek, please, because I'd quite like to hear from a rural perspective as well, because of the makeup of rural communities. So if I could ask Derek, please.
Yeah, I mean, I think in terms of the kind of neighbourhoods and settlements and communities in a rural perspective, we've already talked about the kind of how the dock is older and kind of stone built, and it requires kind of different measures to help insulation. And some of those will compromise the kind of the look of vernacular buildings, for example. You know, you can't necessarily do external wall insulation on those properties. And, you know, the internal wall insulation is problematic because the rooms can be small and it can take a good bit of the room from you. So actually dealing with those older properties is a real challenge, and one that's going to take a lot of expense and perhaps even technological innovation in terms of getting thinner, more effective insulation. In terms of sort of communities and working with communities, I think that's really important. I think communities can be at the kind of forefront of this in terms of helping other people in their areas get a hold of all the measures that they're entitled to, because I think there's an awful lot of people sitting in cold, damp homes who are not aware of everything that they're entitled to or all the support that's available to them. And that's part of why I'm emphasising the need for kind of local community-based approaches to this.
Thank you for that, Derek. And I believe Brian would like to come in too.
Yeah, I think there's a few things in there in terms of that protecting that community. And I think one of the things we look at, certainly from a rural perspective up in Shetland, is making sure that we have sufficient tractors and labourers and everything else that we need to carry out and maintain and carry out the work that we need to try and do. Part of the issue around that comes back down to whether or not they're interested in doing this kind of work. The amount and level and value of work to be done on retrofitting properties in the next 10, 15, 20 years is incredible. And I think there is an opportunity there for localised contractors to take advantage of that. Unfortunately, the barriers that's currently put in place in relation to achieving those standards required to carry out that work as a result of the funding mechanisms that's in place makes that an unattractive option. And my worry is that we'll end up in a, particularly in a rural perspective, having big national contractors coming in to carry out that work on a local basis for us, and any benefit that we would see from that level and value of work not being done locally, and then that being moved out and basically lost to that local community. I think we need to make sure that local community aspect isn't lost to that. So I think, to me, it's making sure we really engage with not just the community, but the contractors within that community, find out what the barriers are for them not carrying out the work that they should be doing, and finding out whether there's anything we can do as a group to try and improve that situation.
Thank you, Brian. I believe Aaron is back with us. Maybe you'd like to come back in on this, and then we're going to move to questions from Paul McLean.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. And again, apologies for the issues. I think the question I was responding to on planning and on kind of preserving local heritage, I think what I was talking about was kind of the culture of planning departments and the leadership that's going to be required locally here. And that's going to be enormously important in terms of responding to sustainability. It's really important that we protect the heritage of local communities, but there needs to be compromise on both sides. So I'm not sure if I got to this bit of my response when I was responding, but you know, there are stories of planners, for example, saying that solar PV should be on the other side of a roof to protect the local characteristics, but you then lose the solar gain from that, and that stops us having the kind of sustainability benefits, the energy efficiency benefits that we would want from some of those developments. So there's a bit of education needed, I think, both in every part of the sector, because this is going to require new ways of working. It's going to require new technologies and things that we've perhaps not seen before and we won't be familiar with. But there's going to have to be a bit of compromise on both sides. So we're not always going to get the perfect development. We're not always going to get the perfect retrofit. But there needs to be a bit of give from planners and from local authorities as well around.
Thank you very much. Thanks for that response. And I'm going to move on to which we already started to touch on, but Paul's going to pick up on skills and supply chain.
Thanks, Convener. Just really to build on the point that Brian made, and I think it's really important, the point he made. He said, obviously, that the next 10 to 15 years, the scale of what we're looking at, is huge, but I think it's really important to reiterate there are massive opportunities on the back of this as well. So I think one of the questions I wanted to ask was around about, and it's building on what Brian said, around about, do we have sufficient skilled labour at the moment to scale up? And what is the government and I suppose councils, and I think you mentioned as well, Brian, about your own housing association, need to do to make sure we scale up that work? And I suppose it then comes back to the point around about, do we have a pipeline of work that's there to attract business in and so on? Just to add one final bit, I think there's been discussions around about local heat and energy strategies we had in the previous panel. I want to ask around about, would it be easier, for example, for each local authority to be looking to plan in that regard as part of a broader national picture? Aaron, I'll probably come to yourself if that's okay, and probably Derek from a rural point of view. I know Brian's touched on that, but Aaron, if yourself, if you wouldn't mind, just open up.
Yeah, thanks. I think on the supply chain more widely, there are issues with both skills and materials. So on the skills point, we've known this opportunity is coming for a long time, but we don't yet quite know exactly what that opportunity looks like. And I think that means that the colleges, for example, the local education providers haven't yet been able to kind of make the commitment to the skills that we are going to need. And so there's kind of this opportunity all on the horizon, but we haven't quite got there. We know that there are fundamental skills, which whatever heating system we land on, whatever retrofit method we land on, we will need. So plumbers, electricians, for example, let's make sure that we are planning for those. Let's invest in that education and get people onto those courses as we can. There will be other kind of accessory jobs around that, which we don't yet know what they look like. And we'll just need to be fleet of foot and agile in responding to that as they come. There's a specific issue around skills, and I can see Brian wants to come in, so I'm sure he will cover this, around PAS 2035, which is the standard effectively for assessing the whole house and the energy efficiency of it and how you respond to that. That qualification is not always available everywhere. It is expensive, and that could potentially provide blockages to us delivering some of this work. So we need to see some investment in that in the short term to get people past 2030 qualified and get that understanding up. On the wider supply chain, I will say, and I'm not going to go into too much detail on this at the moment, it's really difficult at the moment. The supply of materials, not just in terms of costs are up about 20%, 25% year on year. And that's the whole market. But also access, because now we are seeing suppliers not being able to provide those materials. We are seeing lead-in times really extended. And so action to ease that is going to be really, really important, because we're going to be seeing demand for new materials, new technologies. And that's only going to get worse if we don't shorten those supply chains, if we don't invest in bringing those materials into the country where we need them.
Okay. Aaron, just one quick supplementary. You mentioned about skills and workforce. Do we need a national workforce planning strategy around about this particular issue? You touched on everybody's aware of it, but do we need a national strategy around about this? And your view, very briefly, sorry.
So I'm going to be working in Scotland for a couple of months, so I don't feel like I know the education system well enough to perhaps comment on that, but I think it does need to be driven by government, both nationally and locally. Okay.
Thank you.
And I think Brian wanted to come in on this.
Yeah, it was the past 2035 issue that Aaron kind of raised there. I think that's a really important issue to raise, and that's what I touched on in my previous answer. Past 2035 is now the standard that we've got to do all retrofit works to as of June 2021. So any government schemes, funding schemes, are now all linked to past 2035. That requires any staff that you have carrying out retrofit works to that standard to be fully qualified. Training only became available in Scotland in October to be qualified in past 2030. So despite it coming in as a requirement from June, training was only available from October onwards. So we're well behind to begin with in terms of getting the staff up to speed and accredited to carry out that work. It's a requirement to get staff up to what they classify as an SVQ level 6. Now, the belief is that the report came from government is that will take up to 200 hours per person to get to that level of qualification. That's a significant amount of time that, as a company, we're losing somebody to do that kind of level of training. Somebody's basically been doing that same work now, could be for the last 20 or 30 years. So the allowance allows for a ratio of one accredited person for every four on site. But when you're working in rural areas, most of the contractors that are carrying out this work are one or two man bands, which requires both the members of staff to be doing it. And if they're doing 200 hours worth of work, they're not actually able to work as a company during that period. So it is putting people off. We are seeing contractors leaving the sector in terms of that used to do retrofit work. They're not doing that anymore. It's too complex, it's too expensive, and they can't afford to do it. So they're picking up cheaper and easier work, retrofit kitchens, extensions, whatever else it might be, and moving away from that retrofit market. And I think that's something we really need to try and get on top of. And how do we support contractors and make this an easier route? We've seen a massive dropout rate as well through past 2035 from the applicants applying for homeowners. There is a requirement that if you're doing any kind of fabric insulation or air tightness work to your house, and that includes kind of draft proofing or cavity wall insulation, all the stuff that was touched on in your first session from Gilbert's, if you do that, you've got to increase the ventilation to the property. Now, what they're saying is each window needs to have a minimum, I'm getting technical now, but 10,000 square millimetres per window of ventilation. If you're doing any of these types of work, you also need to ensure there's through ventilation in the house. There needs to be a minimum of 15 to 20 mil air gap below each internal door. And all you're doing, certainly in areas like Shetland, if you're punching holes in your outside fabric, is you're creating air movement into the house. By cutting down the internal doors, you're creating drafts within that house. So the ability to actually, you know, you can insulate that wall as much as you can, you can insulate as much draft proof as you want. You punch any kind of hole into the fabric of that building in an area like Shetland, you're just increasing the draft measures that's required in that property. And what we're seeing is a lot of the public are saying, I don't want that. I'm not accepting that in my house, and they're dropping out at a very early stage. So we're seeing a massive reduction of people wanting to actually take part because of past 2035, but actually what we're seeing is a huge drop-off within contractors carrying out that work as well.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for that kind of reality, stark reality check, Brian. I'm going to move on to the next and final theme on infrastructure, kind of fitting. And if anyone else wanted to come in on anything, we'll spend about 5 minutes here. And if you need to tuck something else into your responses because you weren't able to come in earlier, you're welcome to do that. But Miles, do you want to pick up?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Yes, I wanted to ask a couple of questions around infrastructure. Here in Edinburgh, the panel may be aware of the statutory repair scandal, which we've seen in previous times. And so I wanted to specifically start by asking what problems might arise when trying to look towards retrofitting mixed tenure blocks of flats, and does the panel believe that the heat in building strategy actually provides sufficient clarity around the Scottish Government's approach to that multi-tenure, which we see in buildings across Scotland, especially tenements? I'll maybe start with Aaron, and then if anyone wants to come in.
Yeah, thanks for that question. I think I don't feel entirely well placed to kind of comment on the mixed tenure element of it, but I think. And I'm not fully aware of the Edinburgh issue previously, but I think that there's something here in the government's focus in the heat and building strategy, certainly in the early years of that strategy, is very much on social housing. And I think that is an admission that social housing is the easier bit of the market to do, because government have the levers, they have the funding mechanisms, and they have that relationship with social landlords. I've highlighted a few challenges today, which I think hopefully articulate just how difficult that bit of the market is going to be. But if that's difficult, then the homeowners, leaseholders and others are going to be even more challenging. And I don't think we've at all grasped that nettle yet. I think there will be lots of learning from what social landlords do, lots of learning from the engagement with tenants and through engagement with communities and local heat and energy strategies, which need to inform that. But there's a lot more to do. I think what's important is, as I said in my last answer, there will be times where work that is done is not perfect, and it's important that government have mechanisms in place to address that. So emergency redress schemes, for example, where perhaps technologies fail, those sorts of things will be really, really important. There's a lot of learning to do before we get there.
Does anyone else want to come into that question, or
Brian?
Then Bruce.
What I would say was in the heat and building strategy, I think it has been recognised that the complexity around multi-tenure blocks targets being set to achieve most of the standards is 2033. They've recognised that that may not be possible in multi-tenure blocks, so they've extended that through to 2045. So they have recognised that complexity. They've also said within the document that they will develop a bespoke regulating standard for mixed tenure, mixed use buildings. So I think we need to maybe push for that. I think the earlier we can get that, the better, because obviously, as you've kind of alluded to, Miles, that this is probably one of the most complex areas around zero carbon, is dealing with that kind of mixed tenure blocks of flats, and we need that regulation that we're going to have to deal with that now, sooner rather than later, so we can start planning.
And Bruce?
Yeah, mixed tenure blocks are a problem today. I mean, a problem for the last 10 years. I'm sitting looking out my window now at a school, that a housing scheme that's been done up, except for maybe 12 or 14 houses, which creates a problem. And I'm talking about blocks of four, where the council doesn't have the owners. That's the problem. The tenants living in those houses cannot get the upgraded work to save them money in the fuel bill at present, because to replace the insulation in the building is new, they've got to tie into a neighbour's house and they're nowhere in. There's got to be some sort of theme similar to the missing share scheme, where if money is the problem, and in a lot of cases the reason why the work hasn't been done is because the people can't afford it, so there's got to be some sort of grant funding or some way that in a private residence could get the work done, and at a later stage they could claw back the money, where maybe the government could cover a certain amount of that and they both get it in the share of the housing. It would make the communities look better, and I think this is an opportunity. One of the questions earlier on about community coming into it, I think this is an opportunity to bring communities closer together. There is technical problems. There will always be technical problems, but allow the community to be part of the solution to the problem.
Thanks for that, Bruce. That's a really interesting point, and something which I think we all want to pursue, especially around, you know, interest free loans potentially for people who own their properties. But I also wanted to ask, and I'll maybe bring Derek in on this point, and you can cover both, the first and this question, is whether or not the current planning and building standard systems are helping to facilitate this retrofitting activity. And I'll maybe bring Derek in, because I know you had your hand up there.
Yeah, I had my hand up. I was kind of trying to shoehorn another answer into that previous one, which was regarding support for the rural private rented sector, because I think it's really important that we actually deal with this, and we haven't talked about it at all. In that the level of support that's available is minimal, and I think it's having consequences right now, which is the fact that, you know, private landowners and landlords are unable to afford the work that's required to bring properties up to standard, and so they can't recoup that through rents, and the rents become unaffordable. So what's happening is that older stock and other stock in remoter areas is being sold off, or it's been converted into short-term lets. So we have a kind of hollowing out of the rural private rented sector going on. And I think this, you know, the advent of Airbnb and short-term lets and things is encouraging that anyway. And I think what, from the other side of things, the fact that the pressure's on rural private sector to bring the properties up to standard, and something like 63% of properties in that sector have EPCs or F&G, so it's really essential that they're brought up to standards, but they kind of need support, because all that's going to happen is that they're the properties will move out of that sector, and it's a vital sector within rural Scotland, where social landlords are a lower percentage of the households than anywhere else. So we need the provision that's brought in by the private rented sector, because particularly for local business employing people, or schools bringing the teachers or doctors, finding somewhere to live, or even chief executives of housing associations trying to find somewhere to live. So yeah, that's the point I was trying to shoehorn in there.
You did it well. Has anyone else wanted to come in on that second question I asked? I can't see anyone else on the screen at the minute.
No, it doesn't look like it.
If not, I had a tiny final question, which was with regards to unintended consequences. And I wondered specifically to maybe go back to some of the points you've raised today, Derek, with regards to rural fuel poverty. And you mentioned 15% of rural Scotland living in social housing. So, you know, in terms of addressing these issues, it's going to be more difficult. I wondered if, for example, the impact which the recent decision ministers have taken to halt the installation of energy efficient oil and LPG heating systems, that's clearly going to have an impact and doesn't present many alternatives for people to look towards when they're off grid. So I wondered if the panel had any specific concerns around that or issues they wanted to touch upon. Maybe bring Derek back in on that, and if anyone else wants to.
Well, yeah, I mean, I sat for a time on the Rural Fuel Poverty Task Force, and we spent a lot of time talking about kind of transmission charges in Northern Scotland and for electricity. And I think that's, you know, a big consequence of moving towards a more electric-based heating systems. But at the same token, we really shouldn't be installing oil boilers anymore. We need to look towards alternatives. We need to either in biomass or ones which are on air source heat pumps and things, although those demand high levels of insulation in order to work more effectively. So I think it'd be a retrograde step to support the installation of oil-based systems. And I think we need to try and work around ways in which we can make electrical systems more cost effective to the people who are using them, which demands better insulation in buildings and more investment in that.
Thanks, Derek. And I think Brian wants to come in on this as well.
Yeah, no, I think it's a very pertinent question, to be honest, at the moment. Somebody asked a question before about a just transition, and I think this kind of underlines part of the thing we need to be conscious of is, why is this just? Is it just that the rural areas can't access what would be a relatively cheap form of fuel when urban areas are still allowed to install gas boilers? So you're right, we can't install oil and LPG systems now in rural areas, where that made up about 50% of the installs that were being carried out. But if you're doing that in an urban area that is on gas, you can still install a gas boiler. Where's the justice in that? Gas is currently 4 pence a kilowatt hour. I said before, electric's about 25, 28 pence a kilowatt hour. The equivalency of oil is about 68 pence a kilowatt hour. So to not allow that access to that oil-based system, and you know, Derek's right, we shouldn't. But the reality is, given the cost, unless we can deal with that cost, we're putting in systems that are simply not affordable for people to use. And while we're still allowing gas to be used, why are we not still allowing these other systems? It's unconscionable to me that one system in rural areas where you don't have the choice is not being allowed the same choice as somebody in that urban area. I think one thing to kind of follow on behind that is to be conscious of, and I understand it's not within the Scottish Government, Scottish Parliament's purview, is the cost of the tariffs themselves. If you take an electric tariff, you look at your electric bill that you get, and like I said, it's currently about 25 pence a kilowatt hour, is about the cheapest one you'll get. 24% of that bill goes towards what you call environmental and social costs. That's the payment that comes off of that that goes towards funding eco project. If you take the gas bill, 1.8% of that bill goes towards environmental and social costs. We already recognise that Scotland, 97% of our electric grid is renewable. but we're still applying a 24% charge against electric systems to fund decarbonisation of systems, when gas is recognised as being the high carbon cost heating system, only gets a 1.8% charge applied to it. If we remove that element from electric heating, you would knock 6 to 7 pence a kilowatt hour off your electric bill. Now, that still wouldn't bring it into the purview of kind of the cost of gas or oil, but it brings it back down to somewhere that's probably a bit more affordable than what it is at the moment. And where I could, again, within that, is having that conversation with the UK government, try and make it a more equitable position, recognising that electric is the future in relation to zero carbon heating.
Thanks very much for that answer, Brian. Actually, I had made a note to get a bit more detail on exactly that point that you raised. And I think that certainly, as you say, we don't have it's not within our powers to handle that. But I think we do need to start pressing on the UK government to start looking in a different direction in terms of that. So I think we've come to an end. Clearly, we could chat on about this really important issue and very challenging issue for a lot longer. But I just want to say thank you very much for joining us this morning. And I'm going to now briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of panel. Welcome back. We continue taking evidence on this very important issue of retrofitting housing for net zero. And I'd like to welcome our third and final panel for this morning, Stephen Good, who's the Chief Executive of Construction Scotland Innovation Centre, Elizabeth Layton, who's the Director of Existing Homes Alliance Scotland, and Professor Laurie McElroy, who's Professor of Architecture at the University of Strathclyde. Thank you for joining us this morning, and we will move straight to questions. And witnesses, if you would like to respond or contribute to the discussion, please add an R in the chat box to indicate this. We have about 45 minutes this morning, and what we're trying to do is direct our questions specifically to somebody, but do come in, but I may not always take you just in the interest of time. So I'd like to start, and we're going to, I don't know if you saw the panel or previous panel, but we're going to run through the same themes. We're going to start with cost and financing. And I'd be interested in hearing from you whether you believe that the Scottish Government are sufficiently aware of the costs involved with retrofitting homes at a national level. And I think I would start with Stephen Good on that one.
Thank you, Convener. I think certainly from the conversations that have taken place already today and from the work that we are aware of, there's a building body of work around the costs that are involved in retrofitting. But I think we are at a point where there's still a lot to do to understand, particularly examples from the Nidri Road project that was tabled earlier. There's a lot more to understand just exactly how some of the more complex aspects, some of the aspects that are impacted by perhaps planning requirements and various different aspects are actually going to be considered in the round from a cost point of view. And then the other aspect of cost, I suppose, that we are focused on, I suppose, the Innovation Centre is around that issue of skills and upskilling and how do we develop the competencies and capabilities across what is going to have to be a much, much broader workforce in this area going forward. So there's some costs, I suppose you would describe as the sunk costs, to build that capability across the industry that we need to see a significant investment in. And then, I suppose, in other members of the panel will be better placed to address some of this, but I know a lot of the practical project activity that's underway at the moment needs complemented, I think, by perhaps a more strategic approach maybe to the pilot projects or the early Pathfinder projects that we are seeing coming online at the moment. We need a really comprehensive review process, I suppose, of all of those, both domestic and non-domestic, to be able to build a much clearer picture of where those costs are actually going to sit, as opposed to where perhaps the perception is around where they sit at the moment.
Thank you. And perhaps I could bring in Laurie McElroy.
Yeah, I would agree with Stephen, and I also sat in on the previous panel. I think that one of the main issues around funding is that there is a lack of coordination between what happens with private homeowners and private renters and the social sector. I think it was Bruce who was speaking earlier in the previous session about the fact that quite often you end up in a situation where there's one household blocking a whole block of, for example, four in a block flats or other houses from being retrofitted. And these, we really need to put a bit of effort into to looking at these blockers and bottlenecks. I think it's really important that we also that we go in once and we do a full job, a full whole house retrofit, and we do that well. I think that one of the problems that we've had in the past is that there's a pressure on, for example, on local authorities and social landlords to do as many as possible, as quickly as possible. And one of the problems that we have then is that we have unintended consequences of things not being done well or things being partially done and then a need to revisit, which is actually a really inefficient way of doing it. So I think although there is an awareness, I think, within Scottish Government of what the real cost is, but there is a lack of coordination of activity around making sure that this happens in a logical manner to make. I think getting more done well, fewer done well, is more important than getting done as many as possible, as cheaply as possible. And this is where a lot of our efforts are focused at the moment. It's maybe something that Elizabeth might pick up on.
Thank you. I believe we might have lost Elizabeth for a moment. So
I'm
going to continue. I'm going to ask another question. Laurie, I'll keep with you. I'm curious to know what you think about private financing. Will that be required to roll out retrofitting at a national scale?
Yes, I think it definitely will be required. I mean, when you look at all the figures, and I think the government is quite open about the fact that there's a certain amount of money available from government, but it will cost very, very much more. I don't have the figures to hand at the moment, but you know, it's factor of tens and even 100 more to do the full job that needs to be done. So we do need to look at private financing. I know that there's a lot of talk about green finance out there, but we don't seem to have all the ducks in a row, so to speak, in terms of what I think is really important is that if, for example, we're going into an area where it's mixed tenure, we need to be looking at all housing together, and we need to be able to offer ready-made packages to owner-occupiers to make it as easy as possible for them to opt in, because at the moment it's too easy for them to opt out because it's too complex. I think we'll come on to it later, but there is a nervousness out there about the fact that all of this might not necessarily save people money. It will, in most cases, make people more comfortable in their homes, but it won't necessarily save them money if we transition immediately to low carbon heating.
All right, thank you for that. I've got another question which might be for you, Laurie, but also maybe Stephen can come in on that while we're waiting for Elizabeth to come back in. So given the relatively high upfront costs of some retrofitting measures with long payback periods, do you believe financial support is currently in place is adequate? And if not, what is further required? So we kind of touched on that already, but I think this piece of like, what do we need to signal for, you know, things to actually move, things to actually, you said, getting things in a row. So what do we actually need to be doing there?
Sorry, I've kind of lost the thread of the question because it kind of morphed into something else. Could you repeat the first part
of the
question?
Yeah, sure. So it's about the high upfront costs of retrofitting measures with long payback periods. So do you believe the financial support currently in place is adequate?
No, I don't really. I mean, I think, you know, that, for example, and they've changed some of the scheme, that there's a change coming in some of the schemes which will actually reduce the amount of money available for retrofitting measures due to changes at a Westminster level. I think it's rather than a percentage of the cost, they're reducing it to something like £5,000 towards costs of installing, for example, heat pumps. I think that we're throwing everything at the moment at one or two technologies, when really energy efficiency is the first and foremost thing that we should be doing, because the new innovations and technologies won't work unless the housing is insulated to the level where it requires the minimum amount of energy. So we need to focus on getting the insulation done. I'm not saying that we do it first and then go and look at the heating systems, but we have to make sure that we're avoiding unintended consequences by retrofitting homes that are already in the best condition that they can be before we install new energy systems. Because, for example, I mean, I know that Brian was talking earlier about the cost of gas compared with electricity, and there's a massive difference at the moment, partly due to tax, which could be dealt with by Westminster, at least in part, as Brian said. But unless we can reassure the public that their energy costs won't escalate, then you know, I think that we have to make sure that we make their homes as energy efficient as possible in the first place, if that makes sense.
Absolutely, thank you. The fabric first approach, but not just fabric, everything together, as you said in your previous response. And I just wanted to welcome back Elizabeth. Yes, technology still needs to be finessed here. So maybe I'll Elizabeth, with you coming back, I was asking the question about the high upfront costs of retrofitting measures with a long payback period, and whether you believe the financial support currently in place is adequate. So just from your experience of the existing Homes Alliance, do you have any thoughts on that?
Yes, thank you very much, and apologies for connection issues. I think the government is aware of, in the round, what the costs are, and you know, they are massive, they are huge. It is a big challenge ahead of us. And we have some support in place for the self-funding market, which is very welcome and much more than is in place south of the border. That will have to increase over time if we're going to achieve the numbers. As was said in an earlier panel, it's going to have to be about 100,000 homes a year on average that are upgrading. And the government has its own target of 1 million homes to be net zero emissions heating by 2030. So we think there should also be an increase of support for fuel poor programs, fuel poverty programs, Warmer Homes Scotland, and the area-based schemes, because they will have to deliver, as was said, a whole house approach, fabric, as well as zero emissions heating. And so that's more costs per property. And there is also a principle in the heat building strategy that there's a principle, a promise, I like to call it, of no detriment, that nobody's going to be worse off as a result of that upgrade to their property. And they shouldn't be. They should be in a warm and affordable to heat home that that is healthier for them. And so we also need new models of that will accelerate the pace of retrofit. And so we've been working with ChangeWorks on a report that looks at models of collective purchase, bulk buying, payment plans, community ownership, and third-party ownership, different ways of going faster with, you know, neighborhoods of homes that can be taken forward as a group that would be more efficient and cost-effective for everyone. So those are a few ideas about how we can look at this question of who pays and make it a fair transition. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. I'm going to bring in Stephen on this as well, and then we're going to move on to our second theme, which is just transition. Stephen, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. No, just two very brief kind of related points, and I would entirely agree with Laurie's position around the strategy. I think having a kind of whole house retrofit plan, which might be implemented in stages, but it's a plan that's consistent for what needs done to that property or that collection of properties, I think is absolutely key. And then the progress towards that is something that could be managed or could help the affordability, I suppose, the upfront cost aspect of it. So it's not necessary. It's not necessarily everything needs to be done at once, but the plan has to be delivered in a way that's kind of affordable, I suppose. And the two parts I think that are relevant in the context of affordability, upfront costs and the long-term payback. And it was touched on in the previous session, the issue around VAT and the kind of balance of that seesaw between VAT, the incentivisation at the moment to new build over retrofit. I think that seesaw has to swing back, I think, in a more equitable way towards supporting retrofit more adequately. And also, I think the issue of surveyors and house prices and valuations potentially needs to be considered in the context of whether it's a house association or a private landlord or a private owner. The investment that they're potentially going to make in decarbonising their home, there needs to be a equivalent, I suppose, recognition in the valuation, I suppose, of that property. So if you have a street where one property has been retrofitted at the cost of, you know, £20,000-£30,000 perhaps, are we having those conversations to make sure that that's reflected in the ongoing, you know, value of that property perhaps in the future? And I think that's one of the areas where if that was factored in and it was more understandable and there was that recognition at some point down the line, if you were to sell your property, for example, if you're a homeowner, then I think that would encourage more people to make the investment because they recognise that they might get some return on that investment.
Thank you very much for raising that. That's a very interesting point. We're going to move on to the just transition theme, and Eleanor Whitten has questions for that.
Thank you very much, Convener. So quite a few of the questions that I had to ask have actually already been answered in your previous question. So I'm going to slightly change my question a little bit to reflect that. And I would like to direct it to Stephen. So we've heard a lot about the issues in terms of the, you know, the burden of costs on either socially rented tenants or owners and the long payback time, and perhaps even the fact that measures actually might not reduce bills down for individuals. So I suppose the question I have is whether or not, or what actual opportunities and innovation you can see this just transition in terms of retrofit and offering in the country as a whole. So, Stephen, just to put that to you, if you can talk about that, thanks.
Yeah, no, sure. I mean, not a surprise for a person that runs an innovation centre. I think there's huge opportunities around innovation in and around retrofit in a whole number of different areas. So from the kind of development of local supply chains and the development and innovation around new materials in new processes. We've heard previous sessions around Enerfit and Passive House and various different recognised standards that can be achieved, the reference to the quality control aspects of it that can be delivered through things like past 2035 and 2038 for non-domestic buildings. I think there are huge opportunities to really invest in building the capability across our workforce in the built environment. Around the huge task we have ahead of us, I guess, in terms of retrofitting our existing buildings. And that, in the context of a just transition, I think makes the built environment and construction industry and related supply chain parts a hugely attractive place for other industries, perhaps, that are transitioning away from what they do to recognise that there's a real opportunity in the built environment. We need the sort of skills, the transferable skills that will come from industries like oil and gas to help us innovate around the products, the processes, the systems, the finance models, all the various different areas where we know, and again, a very, you know, simple point, I suppose, to make is we already have a lot of the really good innovations already available to us. We just need to deploy them at scale. And again, to previous panel members that have spoken this morning. We need to prove and evidence that those systems are capable of delivering the sort of improvements that we want. But we need to stop, think, a constant cycle of pilot projects. I guess there's a point at which we need to do the pilot programme that ends all pilot programmes, I suppose, is the way to think about it. And then we move to a mass deployment and scale up. And that, in a just transition sense, I think creates a huge number of opportunities to develop the workforce, attract the new talent into the sector as well, because they see it as a sector that's really up in its game around tackling climate crisis and providing solutions. I think that's where the built environment being a big part of the problem could be a massive part of the solution as well.
Thanks very much for that, Stephen. And I wonder if Elizabeth, if you have anything to add from an Existing Homes Alliance perspective on that.
Yes, thank you. We have done some research which shows that, you know, that it's going to be, you know, tens of thousands of jobs, up to 20,000 jobs a year that could be created out of a large scale retrofit program, looking at both the retrofitting for fabric, but also the zero emissions heat side of things. So definitely a huge opportunity. But along with that comes the issue that we do have to plan to support the reskilling, the upskilling of the workforce, so that they're not just in the central belt, they're not coming from south of the border, but we're having those jobs created and sustained all over Scotland, so that we're winning that just transition. So the heat and building strategy does have a plan in terms of supply chain in there, but you know that really needs careful monitoring to make sure that we're matching the demand that's going to be built up alongside with the jobs and the skills in the right places. I was pleased what Stephen said about in terms of innovation, and actually we have a lot of the solutions now that can be deployed, and we have manufacturers in Scotland who can expand, like Mitsubishi, and there are other manufacturers of heat pumps that are considering moving an operation up here as for manufacturing as well as the installation. So, you know, that's another evidence of where they see the opportunities in Scotland, because we're further ahead with the retrofit agenda than in England. Part of that story has to be getting our regulations in place, because until the supply chain is really convinced that the government is going to regulate for standards of both fabric and zero emissions heating, then they won't make their move. But as soon as they're certain those standards are coming, and the heat and building strategy promises a consultation in summer, I believe, of 2022. You know, that it is difficult for them to make those investment decisions. So I'd like to see the government be much more forthcoming about the targets that they have set in the strategy, and work with business about how they can make their investments to meet the demands that they are projecting alongside the standards that will come for all sectors of housing, not just the social sector, not just private rented, but for owner-occupied as well. And that will be a huge game changer. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much for those responses. We're going to move on to our third theme, which is around public engagement and local communities. And I would like to bring in Willie Coffey, who's joining us online.
Hi, thanks again, Convener, and good morning to everybody. I wonder if I could just ask you for your perspective on the wider issue about public engagement and awareness of this whole agenda. If you were listening to the previous panel, you may have heard me say the target is 1 million homes in the next 10 years. It's about 100,000 homes per year that we're expecting to deliver zero emissions and heating systems for. So what do you think we are in terms of the public awareness of this? And what might the role be for the National Public Energy Agency in helping us to get there over the course of that 10 years? Maybe Stephen would like to kick off.
Sure, certainly can do. I think we are at a really interesting point, I suppose. I think on the back of, for example, COP26, the awareness that the couple of years in the lead up to that, and the focus on Scotland through that experience. I think we have a kind of time bound opportunity at the moment to really engage on the back of those big kind of international events to capitalise on the public's interest in this space. There are significant increased awareness, I believe, around the climate and wider kind of natural crisis that we're facing. And I think it would be a real missed opportunity if we don't capitalise on that engagement with communities, with individuals, to really help raise awareness in one aspect, raise knowledge and understanding, and build that appetite, I think, across communities to really, as Elizabeth touched on, to really think about innovative ways in which we can take that interest and that appetite to do the right thing and really turn that into mechanisms that we can use to deliver the right kind of impact and at a scale and pace that we've never seen before. So I think, you know, some of those ingredients, some of those kind of things that have happened in the recent history have sparked an interest in this area that is sort of we've never seen before. So I think that's hugely positive. I think the agency will have to play a vital role in that transformation of, you know, here's what good might look like and here's the challenge it faces us into, here's how we get involved in doing things in a way that we can all contribute as citizens, I suppose. And that for me is probably one of the, should maybe mention in the context of my last answer, but that aspect of you know, the commitment that people are going to be asked to make towards their own contribution to helping solve the climate crisis is one where, yes, there's an individual aspect to it, but there's a kind of citizen aspect to this. Us as members of communities, I think, can work incredibly well together when we're given the right sort of framework to work within. And I think that's where things like the agency could potentially set up really good frameworks that local communities, interested people, can have conversations with. Perhaps, you know, I know from family members, some people are just not engaged in this topic, despite me boring them over every opportunity I get about it. But some people are just not as engaged in it and others. And I think it's that conversation that needs to happen. I think the public awareness campaigns, you know, everything you would want to do if you were trying to push out a massive campaign, and, you know, we've just been through 18 months of massive campaigning around COVID. I think we need to take the same sort of approach and almost make sure no stone's left uncovered in terms of how people can have those conversations.
Thank you, Stephen. Elizabeth and Laurie, perhaps?
Yes, I'm really excited about this because I think, you know, to the commitment that they do have for a public engagement strategy, but they need to go big. And it's something that we have called for in the Scottish budget, that there needs to be a significant dollop of cash put towards a large scale engagement program that isn't just a top down mass communications effort, but it's really tailored and it's supported by the local advisory organizations that we heard about in the previous panel that are absolutely so critical to making this happen, because they're the trusted, credible communicators on the ground who are really going to convince people that, yes, it's a good thing to do and how you do it. We're in a great position in that we have Home Energy Scotland already and a independent national advice service, but it has to be, again, hugely scaled up. And they have a network of partners on the ground. Gaps need to be filled so that every piece of geography of Scotland is covered by that partnership network with multi-year funding. So it's hand to mouth, depending on a grant from a charity here or there. And we need a customer journey that from the start of engagement, right all the way through to making sure the person knows how to use their system and that it's actually using and if working. And if it's not working, they know where to go to get redress. So there's trust in taking forward that retrofit. Stephen's point, they know that they're adding value to their house, not risking. And so we think those pieces together, the National Energy Agency will play a careful part, but we can't sit by and wait for that to be created. We have to take that forward in tandem with our existing delivery and advice infrastructure, so that get ramps up in this next year and really gets people excited about how their home is going to be a nicer, warmer, more comfortable place to live.
Yeah, thank you, Elizabeth. Laurie?
I would agree with everything that's been said so far, but I think also that there's a general awareness of the fact that we need to do something, but people expect someone to do it for them. And those who do want to push ahead are not always clear about where to go. I know that Home Energy Scotland does a great job, but even as someone who works within the industry, I don't find that organisations like that are accessible enough to the general public. People, if someone wants to put a heat pump into the house, they don't know where to go, they don't know what funding's available. So I think that we need to have a much wider, more general campaign around this, even to sort of set up some, maybe through the National Energy Agency, to set up some sort of network of local champions within communities, and sort of ways of spreading the word. And I think we have to make it as easy as possible for people to get involved. I know that, for example, I mean, I know this is an anecdote, but I mean, I know that in the street where my mother lives, she lives in an ex-local authority house, and understanding of what people who still were with the local authority were going to get in terms of an upgrade, and how long people who were in their own homes had to wait to join the party, just seemed to me to be ridiculous. And then there, you know, one company came in and then another one came in, and eventually my mum had her house upgraded. But the point was that it should all have been done seamlessly. She shouldn't have known that there was a difference between what was happening with her and what was happening with others. So I think that we need to make it easier, but I also think that we need to really, as Elizabeth said, you know, really raise awareness, but not from a top-down perspective, to sort of take people along with us. And I know that that's not easy, but I also think that funding plays a big part in this, because as soon as people become worried about funding and worried about being asked to do something that they don't think they can afford to do, they'll back off, whereas you need to get them through the door so that they can find out what the opportunities are.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, thank you for that, Laurie. Thank you, everybody. Really interesting and helpful answers. Thank you for that. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you, Willie. And we're going to move on to another theme, local communities, and question from Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. You might have heard from the last panel that I'm quite interested in the relationship between retrofitting and protecting the distinctive characters of individual places. So I'd like to ask you all, how do we protect the character of a community whilst implementing retrofitting? And how do we involve communities to make sure that they are behind the planning and the planning that's involved in retrofitting? And if I could start with Elizabeth, please.
Right, thank you for that. I think one of the first answers that comes to mind is, by retrofitting, we avoid demolition and destroying communities. And so the conversations that were had before, the cost benefits of actually doing a whole house retrofit and taking a whole life approach to it, means that we're actually, you know, saving money in the long run. And there are all the co-benefits in terms of well-being, community cohesion, resilience. So that's a first benefit of doing the retrofit in the first place, and doing it in a way that, again, it takes this whole house approach, so that it is fit for purpose in terms of our net zero future. So that investment is well spent going forward. A lot of the area-based schemes, I think, can offer us lessons of involving the community, where research has been done to show communities are proud of their neighborhood. You know, it looks good and people want to live there, and they say it's really improved their health and well-being. And I think the local heat and energy efficiency strategies, if well enough resourced, should be able to work with local groups, local development trusts, you know, community organizations, to involve people in the decision making about what's the right approach to in their community, those models of how we pay for it. You know, how can we do this in a way that we can perhaps take it on as a community asset, or we can arrange a collective purchase? You know, what's the right solution for us? And I think that would, again, be a way of engaging people with the transition that's in a much more positive way. But I did mention that word resource. It does mean local authorities are going to need the resource and the capacity to develop and then implement those local heat and energy efficiency strategies. And I think we're all aware that they're pretty thin on the ground. And so that, again, is something that we called for in the budget, and that resourcing is provided.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to move on to... Sorry, Laurie wanted to come in as well.
Yeah, I just wanted to... Well, I agree with what Elizabeth said, and we have been working with some local authorities where that is their approach, where they have a strong community and they don't want to uproot that community. They are focusing on improving the area, the existing area, even in homes, you know, where the homes are really in quite a poor state. But if they can in any way retain the social cohesion within that community, they are doing that. I think it's one of the ways is to for whoever the housing is owned by to speak to the tenants and homeowners in the area to look at different approaches that are appropriate to their lifestyles and sort of have a much more engaged approach, because quite often people, I think one of the dangers with existing homes and retrofitting of existing homes is that people are often told that they are, one of the lines that we hear a lot is that the occupants need to be taught how to live in their home. And that to me is I wouldn't say it's a ridiculous statement, but it's a bit of a misnomer or a misunderstanding of the fact that if people are having a home that they've lived in for 20, 30 years retrofitted, then whoever is doing the work should be learning about how the home is used and how people live in the home at the moment, so that it's as easy as possible for them to get the most out of the retrofitted home as possible. As I say, some local authorities are already doing that. There's also quite a bit of work going on in Ayrshire and Dumfries and Galloway on looking at health benefits. And this is another thing that can be used as a kind of a lever, because there are clear records beginning to emerge of the health benefits of living in a warm, dry home, compared with the state that people were living in before, and reduced admissions to hospitals. So I think there's a lot around that from a community perspective, that just again the word on the benefits of all of this needs to be spread more widely.
Thank you, and I'm happy to pass back to yourself, convener.
Thank you, Megan, and we're going to move on to some questions from Paul McClellan around skills and supply chain.
Thank you, convener. Just to kind of move on, and I think it's kind of been touched on around the local heat and energy strategies as well in that regard, and I'll come on to a question on that, but it's really just around about how can Scottish Government and officials and councils, in addition to industry, support the development of the necessary skills to upskill retrofit work? And I suppose it's establishing a pipeline as well. We heard from the previous panel around about some contractors moving away. So obviously they need the supply there, if you like, the pipeline, to make sure that happens. So Elizabeth, I'll probably come to yourself first of all, if that's okay, just to open up.
Yes, as I was saying earlier, that that needing that certainty through the regulation, but also with the local heat and energy efficiency strategies, that's going to tell people what, you know, in a sense, what the destination is. And until they know that, people and often the supply chain will be reluctant to move. So the faster we can get those done, and we've encouraged the government local authorities to actually start implementing those that have already been developed, because there are some that have been done in the early stages. On the supply chain, there's an interesting example, heat pump sector deal, where government has been working with industry as well in terms of preparation to meet these targets, and what do they need from government, having that conversation. I think their interim report is out, final to be out soon, but it'd be very interesting to hear how the government responds to that, and if there's scope to do similar types of sector deal arrangements, or at least informal arrangements with other parts of the industry, and find out how programs like the area-based programs could be improved to allow them to make more investment going forward, multi-year funding, multi-year arrangements that they're delivering on those schemes, I'm sure would help with that situation, to give them that security.
Okay, thank you. Laurie, I don't know if you want to touch on that. And I suppose, Stephen, from your point of view, talking around about the pipeline, I don't know if you want to say anything on the pipeline about how to develop that as well from that point of view. Sorry, Laurie, just yourself first, and then I'll bring Stephen.
Will I go first? Yeah.
Yeah.
I think there's a lot of really good work going on at the moment on looking at skills and making sure that colleges are able to upskill existing workforce, as well as making sure that young people coming into the construction industry have the right skills. I think something that could be looked at, I think we've touched on it already, is if this became a more regulated thing, I mean, in terms of building regulation requirements for retrofit, that might even increase the attractiveness of it. But I think that the work that is going on at the moment is already having an impact. But the biggest problem seems to be with supply chain availability. I know from speaking to a number of social housing providers with large area-based schemes, that there are very few providers able to do large scale retrofit programs. A lot of them come up from down south. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but that we don't seem to be building a capacity at the speed that we need to build it in Scotland. So, and that's maybe something that Stephen can pick up on. I think it seems to have been exacerbated through material shortages post Brexit. But I do know of one scheme, a scheme that was purportedly was going to be funded by BEIS, which with a local authority up here, where the supplier came in and told the local authority what they would do, rather than adopting the approach that local authority had requested, and I know that the scheme fell apart because of that. And so I think that there seems to be a bit of a kind of what's the word? Well, because there is a dearth of competition, the people who are out there have one way of doing it, which is not always the best way of doing it, and that's all that's on offer. So I think there's a lot around that, and we really need to ramp that up very, very quickly if we're going to move it forward.
Thanks for that. And just as you said, just to bring Stephen in, Stephen, just obviously in the supply chain and obviously the pipeline, I think the key thing, I think, for me is there's big opportunities. You know, I know there's challenges, but there's big opportunities, I think, for industry in this. So just your comment on that.
Yeah, I mean, the opportunities are immense for the entire sector. And I think, to points that have been made previously, you know, the opportunity to develop a local capability, I think, is massive. A couple of things in terms of the pipeline. So I suppose we contribute to the Construction Leadership Forum, which is a partnership between industry leadership and government that has been developing over the last 18 months. The restart plan for industry post-COVID, the recovery plan for industry now, and now moving forward to the sort of transformation plan, which is very much focused on the opportunities around zero carbon. And within that, we now have pipeline tools, so public sector organisations are able to share their programmes moving forward on a dashboard effectively that Scottish Futures Trust hosts, and that gives tractors, other clients, you know, supply chain partners, the opportunity to see a little bit more clearly down the road and round the corner about what's coming. So that can help build a little bit more confidence in terms of that decision to invest in skills or technology or innovation, whatever it may be. So there's real value, I suppose, in having those tools. And as they get more sophisticated, as there's more content in there, which always has that slight degree of uncertainty, but it's certainly good to see what that pipeline looks like if you're a contractor or an architect or whatever. That, I think, gives confidence to businesses in one aspect around pipeline. The other aspect of it is around the opportunities, I think, for businesses that are, and we work with quite a number of businesses that are looking at the materials innovation side of things, so developing new circular, perhaps, recycled materials, products that are locally manufactured from either our natural resources, timber being an obvious one that we should be doing a lot more with in a sustainable way. Those businesses are I think, much more confident that the direction of travel is going to be in a way that's much more obvious now around the move towards net zero, the move towards circular, sustainable, you know, embodied carbon being a really important part moving forward. I think industry partners are spotting, and things like Scottish National Investment Bank are investing in some of those real opportunities to create local supply chains that support local pipelines, that are delivering really innovative solutions that are not just suitable for our challenges in Scotland, they're eminently exportable, which I think in a kind of economic development sense are huge opportunities for Scotland as well, because we have great capability. We need to scale it up, yes, but when we do that, we have the opportunity, as in the reverse way to Laurie touched on, rather than having contractors coming north of the border to deliver solutions, we would have the capability to export that south of the border and elsewhere, which I think should be a big key part of this this proposition.
Thanks all.
Thank you for those responses. We're going to move on to the next and final theme, which is infrastructure and questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I wanted to ask maybe the question I asked to the previous panel to yourselves with regards to problems around mixed tenure blocks and properties and how retrofitting can be taken forward there. So I just wondered if you'd outline your views to the committee with regards to that and any experience you've already had of that being one of the barriers we're likely to see to meeting these targets. I'm not sure who wants to come in maybe first on that. Maybe go to yourself, Professor or Elizabeth. Thanks.
I'll come in quickly. Obviously, it's a big blockage. The obvious solution is if we have a cross-tenure standard so that every property has to meet a high standard in terms of energy efficiency, and also zero emissions heating. And I would include holiday lets in that, which would also help to solve the problem of people shifting their properties to holiday lets to avoid regulation. Mixed and with tenements, we're aware that, you know, it's difficult to, there are difficult legal issues involved with that, but there's been a very comprehensive report with recommendations done by the cross-party working group, tenements working group in the previous parliament, and the Law Commission has been asked to look into that. And we'd recommend that, you know, additional resource was provided to the Law Commission so that they could take this work forward at speed rather than over, you know, several years, even 5 years before we'll have recommendations on how to address those legal issues, which I think is unacceptable. So that would be our approach to that. The other will be engagement, I would say, is that more on a voluntary basis, that more of the type of community engagement we're talking about would have blockers.
Thanks for that. Does anyone else want to come in? No. Another question which I also had was with regards to the current planning and building standard systems we have in place and how that can really help turbocharge and take forward this retrofitting activity. So I wonder if there's anything from your experience around that which you think is also preventing us moving forward at a faster pace. Laurie, did you want to come in on that?
There has always been a sort of there's always been a view within building standards that the focus should be on new buildings, but the recent discussion around building standards reforms have included a more clear view of what constitutes a major retrofit, and so we are beginning at last to move in the direction of existing homes coming into the fray in terms of requirements for upgrading in terms of a change of use or if any major works are being done. I think it's something to do something around 25% of the value of the home, and the same for non-domestic buildings. So I think we are beginning to move in the right direction on that. I think that we should be firmer on it and clearer on it. For example, one way of dealing with it, with the issue that you just asked Elizabeth about, in terms of triggers and encouraging people in mixed tenure accommodation to get better engaged, would be if at change of tenancy or change of ownership, there's a requirement to upgrade to a certain standard, and that could be built into the building standards more explicitly. If a house needs to be rewired, for example, or the roof needs repaired, then that's an automatic at the moment, that you couldn't sell a house in that kind of state of disrepair. But the same thing could be included for housing at change of occupancy in terms of its energy efficiency. So, as I say, we're beginning to move in the right direction, but we haven't quite done that yet.
Thank you for that. And in terms of financing this, what does the panel think is really needed, especially for private residents to look towards how, you know, these are significant costs we're going to be expecting people to meet? You know, boiler scrappage schemes or interest-free loans backed up by the government. Do the panel have any other suggestions around how we could actually make private residents able to realise some of this future costs? Would anyone like to?
Hi, it's Stephen. Stephen here. I'm happy to have a bash at that one. I mean, it is some governments, I suppose, have struggled with this challenge of how do you incentivise people to do things that perhaps they don't feel overly incentivised to do. And I suppose some of the points that have been made there by Laurie are part of the answer. Some of the lessons, I suppose, from the experience through Green Deal historically, and I think one of the big challenges, and this is where I suppose it starts to think about this in a very systematic way, is that, you know, people would be much more inclined to invest in their building to deliver, you know, savings if they had a much, much higher degree of confidence, I think, that those investments were going to deliver those savings. And I think that's where we have historically had a fair number of challenges, in so much that the promise, and I think Chris made the point this morning from John Gilbert Architects, that you know, there is a risk that you ask people to invest in solutions that on the surface of it, the design intent is going to deliver the benefit, but actually the reality as delivered doesn't deliver those benefits. And I think we need to understand, and it's through pilot projects that Nidgee Road and others are really good pathfinders for, if we build and gather the evidence appropriately from them. They can help us inform where we can and should make those sorts of investments, and then where are the incentives that are actually going to work. I can't remember the name of it, but there is a, I think in a global context, I believe there's a German system of the Green Deal that has been in play for probably the last 20, 25 years. And as I understand it, it is one of the most well-used and most you know, confidently backed up in terms of certification sort of approaches that we're certainly aware of. And I think that is something we should be looking at, is where are the kind of international best practice models from countries that have perhaps been doing this a little longer, and how can we learn and perhaps adopt. You know, there's no kind of it needs to be invented here necessarily. You know, if there's good ideas and good solutions elsewhere, we should be quite open and willing to adopt them.
Thanks, Stephen. We've all just scribbled down German system, so we'll be away to investigate that. Would anyone else like to come in, or if not, happy to hand back, Convener? Elizabeth, thanks.
Sure. I'll comment on both planning and building standards. Just comment on the new build standards. They can have if those could be brought forward and implementation even accelerated in publicly funded projects, that would be a huge boost in terms of your pipeline question you were asking, and also bring down the costs for everybody, because that would be a huge investment in heat pumps and a changing of people's mindset of what's good in a new property. Planning, I think there is a promise to look at restrictions related to for permitted development And I think, you know, we should be absolutely making it easy for people to install these renewable technologies. And also on traditional buildings, that question was raised earlier, you know, this, how can we do this in a way that preserves the character, but also gets us to zero emissions? Because after all, it's no point preserving the character if those buildings don't survive the impacts of climate change. So we have to keep our eye on the prize. So I think, and on the financing, there are ways that we can design regulation to ease the pain, in a sense, ease the cost by making it at the point of sale where it can be picked up in the sale price, or when you're doing refurbishments, when it would be more cost effective to do refurbishment, and also in the support mechanisms that we were talking about earlier, the loans, the cash back, boiler scrappage. You know, there are schemes to make this easier for people so that it is less of a burden, and then to see the return on their investment when they sell their house.
Thanks. Thanks very much.
Thank you, everyone, for your responses. I just want to explore a little bit something I've been become aware of, and to see if this is useful. It's around the 44,000, I think it is, empty homes across Scotland. And I've begun to think about, you know, intervention points into this retrofitting initiative. So obviously, an empty home in a tenement wouldn't work because we want to do the whole building approach. But in rural areas, I'm just beginning to wonder if we could bring empty homes back online, so to speak, and before we house people in them, actually use them as the potential for retrofitting, so that people are going into houses that are retrofitted. And I'd love to hear your thoughts on that. Maybe I'll start with Laurie.
Yeah, and I mean, there has been a fair amount of work done on looking at this in the past. I suppose it depends who owns the home. I think one of the there's been quite a lot of resistance from rural private landlords to some of the retrofitting agenda in terms of the huge costs. But as you say, in terms of demonstrating sort of creating demonstrator homes across the country, it is another kind of a risk of there being another pilot scheme, but it is a way of spreading knowledge and spreading the benefits. But yeah, I think there should be a requirement for homes to be in a fit state to be occupied, and therefore, you know, a home shouldn't be able to be let unless it comes up to a certain standard in terms of energy efficiency. So it might also be a way of testing innovations in terms of energy systems and materials across the country, and allowing smaller SMEs to sort of test out the territory in a small scale way.
Thank you for that. And does anyone else want to come in on that before we close? Elizabeth.
I would just say, you know, it should be a point of principle that public money is, if it's supporting bringing empty homes back onto the market as they've done in the past, then public money should be investing towards meeting our wider goals on fuel poverty and climate change as well. And so they should be bringing them up to the standards that are proposed in the heat and building strategy. But it would be a very welcome initiative to help bring more homes onto the market in rural areas, but it's a problem in urban areas as well.
Thank you very much for that. So we've come to the end. Unfortunately, as always, we never really have enough time, but it's been very, very helpful. I think all members of the committee agree with me to hear from you and the other panels this morning on this. And as I said at the beginning of the morning, this is not the first time we're going to be taking evidence on this. It's been very helpful. And we are going to be leading a debate in the Parliament in January on retrofitting. So hopefully we'll see what comes out of that. And your contributions have been very helpful there. So thanks again, and I'm now going to suspend momentarily for the witnesses to leave. The third item on our agenda today is consideration of the Ethical Standards in Public Life, Scotland Act 2000, Register of Interests Amendment Regulations 2021. This is a negative instrument, and as such, in the absence of a motion to annul, there is no requirement on the committee to make any recommendations on it. I'd like to invite committee members if they have any comments. No. And committee members online, any comments? No? Okay. The committee has agreed that we don't want to make any recommendations in relation to this instrument. As agreed earlier in the meeting, we will consider items 4 and 5 in private. I now close the public part of the meeting and we will move into private.